buddy is up in the high twos to high twos to threes. You've got guys like Nathan Archer, 0.258, Sam Seidel, 0.278. All of these high batting averages, they get on base a lot, and that's the big thing about this team. They've had some pitching woes, but right now they're up against bottom of the MAC Akron, and they're looking to get that third sweep, and wouldn't it feel so sweet to be 9-0?
One, this power for this team has really come out of nowhere compared to last season. Last season, you look at the team basically ranked bottom of the MAC, if not the worst in the MAC, and every offensive statistical category, picked to finish eighth in the MAC this season in the preseason poll. Right now, leading the Mid-American Conference, 2 wins in the MAC more than any other Mid-American Conference team, which is Toledo, who sits at, I believe, 6 wins right now. But that power was shown yesterday, Bowling Green launching 3 home runs, including Gavin Gannon with that grand slam in the bottom of the eighth. So this offense really starting to just heat up and stays firing on all cylinders right now.
And that grand slam by Gannon was an absolute game changer. You look at that game yesterday, Akron were putting up numbers. It was a close game up until that point. They were sticking around, but because the offense is so reliable, you can go to different guys to make those plays. You don't have to rely on one slug or anything like that. They can get consistency out of that team, and that's why they're sitting at the top of the MAC.
And we look over to Akron. Akron came into the series on a 2-game winning streak. They look to be starting to kind of find something after having been a runt for a few weeks coming into this. And they've dropped the first two. They've hung around in yesterday's game. Friday, they were pretty much outmatched the entire contest. But what surprised you about this Akron team so far?
This Akron team was picked to be bottom of the MAC. You expect what you see. But the thing about this Akron team that I am a little bit surprised about is their ability to have some good games. They were on a 2-0 win streak before they actually came to Stellar Field. That now that they're here, they kind of look like a different team. They have a good win over Duke in the ACC.
A very good win over Duke.
A great win.
Nationally ranked.
It's just...
And I believe they were ranked 10th in the country at the time that they beat them.
At the time. But it's probably not anymore after losing to Akron, but still a very strong couple of games for this squad. But right now, it just feels like they're in a rut. It looked like they were going to pull one out yesterday. It looked like they were just getting everything to go their way. But I'm going to keep saying it throughout this broadcast. You cannot stop the Falcon offense. The runs that they are going to score, you have to be able to match that every single time. And it's just going to be hard for this Akron Zips team.
So when you look at this Akron team, what are you looking for them? What do they need to do to come out with a victory? Because we've talked about Bowling Green's struggles a little bit with relief pitchers. They've been good starting pitching-wise. And, of course, we talked about the offense. And, dominant so far. So if you're Akron, what is your key to success?
I think you have to take advantage of the situation you're given right now. Starting pitcher for the Falcons, Rigo Ramos, has not the best ERA in the world. Actually, I think it's pretty low, sitting at around 9 runs allowed, something like that. And that's something you have to cash in on early. Let me get the number here because it is a little eye-opening. Ramos has a 9.69 ERA. That's not something you're going to want to see if you're the Falcons. And he's starting off. You're getting your best batters to go at him early. That's going to be a hard thing for the Falcons to do. Or that's going to be a hard thing for Akron. Hard thing for the Falcons to do is match a sort of start off well pitching-wise. If you can start off well pitching-wise, if Ramos can kind of catch Akron off guard and not allow those early runs, they'll be fine throughout the match. But Akron, if you can cash in on those hits early and get on base early and create those opportunities to score, the Falcons might be in for some trouble here at home.
And if you're Bowling Green, what's going to be your key to success? We talked about the offense, but are you looking at something else?
I think pitching has been a struggle, and the Falcons know that. You see, last game they went through 5 different pitchers throughout that matchup. They just couldn't find anything. They had Nick Good, who allowed 8 hits, 3 runs, and 3 earned runs. So He let up some scoring. He was in there for a majority, but then they just couldn't find that consistent relief pitcher. They go through Wilson, Bell, Miller, Turner.
Well, and the piggyback on that, Turner did a good job closing it down, but to your point, Peyton Wilson, Logan Bell, Perry Miller all came in and struggled with command their entire outing. None of them going over an inning for them, so that is something that they're looking for, is that depth in that relief pitching. So we will take a few-minute break. National Anthem coming up here in a few minutes, so we'll go through that and then come back to you, go over Akron's starting batting order, and get to a little bit more about Rigo Ramos, dive into him a little deeper. And then baseball time between Bowling Green and Akron, final game of this opening homestand for the Falcons. You're listening to Bowling Green Baseball on 88.1 WBGU.
Cole Moore is a CCHA Goaltender of the Week for his performance last weekend. Freshman Cole Moore recorded 32 saves through 43 minutes on Friday night in the 3-3 shootout win over St. Thomas. Moore saved every shot he saw on Friday night, including the shootout. On Saturday, Moore recorded 30 saves and allowed one goal. Moore recorded a 92.2% save percentage and a 2.64 goals allowed on average through 20 games. Moore's record is now 10-9-1 on his rookie season. Moore was named CCHA Goaltender of the Week earlier this month and also on December 11th. He was named Rookie of the Month on January 3rd. This has been 62nd and Falcon Athletics on WBGU 88.1 FM, Northwest Ohio's community radio station.
Did you know that people born from 1945 to 1965 have the highest rates of hepatitis C, but most don't know they're infected? People can live for decades without symptoms, but over time, hepatitis C can cause serious health problems, including liver damage and even liver cancer. If you were born from 1945 to 1965, the CDC recommends that you get a blood test for hepatitis C. So talk to your doctor about getting tested. It could save your life. A message from the CDC.
Hey everybody, Rachel Ray here. Nothing brings a bigger smile to my face than cooking up a big meal for the whole family and lots of friends. But there's not enough room at my table for the 17 million kids in our country who struggle with hunger. That's why the Feeding America nationwide network of food banks collects surplus food to give hope to hungry kids. But they can't do it without your help. Support Feeding America and your local food bank at feedingamerica.org.
A message from Feeding America and the Ad Council.
Sweet strawberry icing.
You're in Goodwill, and just past that vintage denim jacket, you spot miniature donut earrings. You lean in. Ah, that's the scent of shopping success. Because at Goodwill, every item you buy funds local job training and more. So bring home those donut earrings, and bring home so much good to your community. Goodwill. Bring good home. Brought to you by Goodwill and the Ad Council.
This is Artie Abrego, and you are listening to 88.1 FM WBGU Bowling Green, home of the Falcon Media Sports Network.
Imagine being fired because of who you love. Imagine being denied medical treatment because of who you marry. Imagine being evicted because of who you are. Millions of Americans don't have to imagine this. They have to live it. Because in 31 states, it's legal to discriminate against LGBT people. Get the facts at beyondido.org. Brought to you by the Gill Foundation and the Ad Council.
Back here at Stellar Field, just about to get underway. Bowling Green Akron, third game of this three-game homestand for the Falcons. Tyler Cavillett's here with Chaz McNeil. And Chaz, let's go through this Akron starting batting order. It will be Evan Batone, the center fielder, leading off. Nikki Sackett, the shortstop, will be in the two-hole. Max Bowman, the first baseman, the second baseman, will be in the three-hole. Batting cleanup will be Austin Lafferty. He will be in left field. Batting fifth will be Charlie Schebler, the DH. He batted fourth yesterday. Braden Cavey, the first baseman, will be sixth. Sam Seeker, right fielder, will be seventh. Michael Sprockett, behind the plate, will bat eighth. And Henry Heyman, the third baseman, will bat ninth, rounding out their order. But let's also get to the starting pitcher for Bowling Green. It will be Rigo Ramos. And like you mentioned, Rigo, not the best ERA coming into this one, 9.69. He does not have a decision on the season. This will be his third start and sixth appearance overall. He's started the past two Sunday games. He's pitched 13 innings, 14 strikeouts, 12 walks.
That's right. The Archibald, Ohio native, he's led up a pretty high ERA, closing on Sundays, and kind of brought in as a relief guy to the end of a long series. And Ramos, like you said, 13 innings pitched is not the most in the world, but he's got a couple games under his belt. Ball State, that's a win. Miami, that's a win. While he's not credited with those wins, still big closeout decisions for Ramos.
And first pitch is down and low. We're underway. Start time, 1:03 p.m., 40 degrees here in Bowling Green. As this one left high, 2-0 start from Ramos. We do have about 12-mile-per-hour winds blowing in a little slightly to left field. As working from the windup is Ramos. This one high again, 3-0. The defense for Bowling Green looks like this. Tackett's at first, Ross second, Seidel third, Seidel short, Banjoff third, Gunnun left, Archer center, Kraus right. As this one outside again, so 4-pitch walk to start the game for Ramos, and Garrett Wright behind the plate, that battery for Ramos and Wright.
That's not something you want to see early if you're Ramos. Start of the game, obviously there might be a little bit of jitters or, you know, getting your arm calibrated, but right now getting a Akron batter on base is not something you want to see with a strong lineup up front.
And he has struggled with walks this season, 12 walks in 13 innings pitched, walked 3 batters in his last outing against Ball State, a 3-inning start. Now here's bunt shown there by Sackett. It will go down as a strike for Ramos, his first of the game. Sackett yesterday went 2-for-5 at the plate. As Ramos goes to the plate, this one, we're going to have a dead ball. Looks like it came inside and hit Sackett. So already runners on first and second for Akron, still no one out. Some command issues early on for Rigo Ramos.
The second baseman.
Like you mentioned, this isn't the start that you want to see from Rigo. You want to see him start pounding that zone a little more. So Max Bowman will step up to the plate. 1-for-5 on Friday. Went 2-for-5 yesterday. Drove in a run. As Ramos now working from the stretch. Delivery to the plate, left up high once again. So just leaving that fastball up high right now a few times in these first couple batters, as Garrett Wright will go out to the mound to talk with him.
This is a surprise. Ramos is third on the team in strikeouts and hasn't even gotten more than a strike yet today.
He has allowed the most walks on the team. Look to try to get back into the zone here. Now that wind blowing heavy out to left field. See the flag shift. Ramos, the 1-0 delivery. This one in there for a strike, evens the count. Middle infielder is playing that double play depth. Interesting. Tackett's just on the edge of that infield grass, up in front of the runner. The 1-1 pitch, this one left high and outside, 2-1 the count. So Rigo still just getting behind these batters, just still struggling with that command early on here. His fifth season at Bowling Green. Ramos's pitch, down low or inside, one of the two or both. 3-1 the count now. Ramos didn't play 2 years ago due to an injury. Came back last season. started 8 games for the Falcons last season, had a 2-3 record with a 5.79 ERA. So he was a guy that ate up innings for them. His 3-1 pitch, this one high and outside. So 2 walks and a hit batter to start the game by Rigo Ramos, not the start you want.
Especially with bases loaded, with Lafferty coming in. Lafferty on Friday, 4 at-bats, no hits. But yesterday, he was 1 at-bat, yeah, 1 hit. So he went perfect yesterday. Not something you want to see with bases loaded.
And Bowling Green has scored first in both the games in the series. Akron looking to do some damage first in this one. Like you mentioned, Austin Lafferty, the left fielder at the plate now. Ramos comes set the delivery. This one in there for a strike with the fastball. Finally gets ahead of a batter, does Ramos.
It's all about getting right for Ramos. Just getting that first strikeout, getting that first out is going to go a long way for the fifth year.
And this fastball left a little high, so 1-1 the count. Lafferty, the freshman from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. He's started now 4 of the past 5 games for the Zips, working his way into that starting lineup. As he'll pop this one up, it will be an infield fly rule. Seidel will settle under it. He'll make the catch. So automatic out regardless. Bases will stay loaded. Now 1 out for the Falcons.
Well, that's not exactly the perfect out you want to see. It's something. It's you're building something here. First inning, got to get those jitters out of the way. Starting with all of those walks is not going to help. So getting that first out is going to be crucial, and it hopefully will be.
So now Charlie Schebler stepping up to the plate. Schebler struggled this series, going just 1-for-8 at the plate, including an 0-for-4 outing yesterday. Big cut at this one on the first pitch. Can't connect with it. Ramos gets ahead of his second straight batter, 0-1 the count. Schebler coming into this contest with a .333 batting average on the season. This is his 6th start in 11 appearances. Delivery from Ramos. The left-hander gets the outside corner. 0-2 the count. Strikeout would be big here for Ramos and the Falcons. The lefty comes set from the stretch. Takes a breath, his delivery. This one fouled off. We'll do it again at 0-2.
Schebler staying alive in this very, very exciting opportunity for Akron with the bases loaded.
Schebler had a 4-game hitting streak come to an end yesterday. Was starting to heat up. It's Ramos now with a slower delivery here. This one drilled right center, fairly deep. It's going to be caught by Krause. Jack Krause will throw into Seidel, but a run will come across to score. As that's Evan Batone coming across the score for Akron. So the Zip strike first, get on the board. But there are now 2 outs for Bowling Green.
It was a little bit of a pick-your-poison play because with that drive, bases loaded, you knew that there would be an opportunity for an Akron Zip to go home. And that throw by Archer was just not in the right spot, maybe just a little bit too short, and because of that, it allowed a runner to get home.
So Braden Cavey will step into the plate, first baseman for the Zips, as we'll have a double steal here now. Throw to third base by Wright, not in time, so Akron pulls off the double steal. That was Nicky Sackett stealing third and Max Bowman stealing second for the Zips. So Akron aggressive on the base pass early. Now 2 runners in scoring position for Braden Cavey with 2 outs. Timely hitting is what Akron has really struggled with this series. We'll see if they can take advantage of this situation here. This pinch left up high once again by Ramos. Count at 2-0. You'd have to imagine that KB is sitting on a pitch here at 2-0 count. Ramos from the stretch catches the inside corner, 2-1. And if you're Ramos, you really want to escape this inning without letting up any more damage. This one catches the corner once again, evens the count at 2-2. Rigo looking to work quick. Cavey takes a second to get back to the box. Big pinch here for Rigo Ramos. The 2-2 delivery. Grounded foul to the left side, so we'll do it again. And if you're Akron, you really need to capitalize on this opportunity. They've left too many runners on base in these first two games.
Falcons actually doing a solid job of keeping the bleeding to a minimum.
As this pitch by Rigo is checked by Cavey and fouled off to the Akron dugout. Looked like he didn't even really want to go. Ball found the bat. So we'll do it again at 2-2. Ramos now working from the windup. Taking a second to look in. Now Ramos from the windup. The delivery off speed misses up high. Full count 3-2.
Now that's not something you want to see if you're Ramos with a full count after having two strikes and just letting the batter stay alive. In this opportunity with bases loaded, you walk three batters. This is not something you want to see if you're Ramos.
Second and third for Akron, two outs. Top of the first here. Pitch by Ramos. Full count misses inside. So Ramos now with his third walk of the first inning. As many walks as he had in three innings in his last start. As we'll have a visit to the mound here.
And I think that's what you need to do early. You need to have the conversation. The walks are not something you want to continue, obviously. And just, you see with a lot of those pitches, they feel like they're just slightly off the mark in the wrong spots. A lot of his strikes have just been right on the edge. A couple right down the middle, but it's all about just getting back to that consistency, getting back to that level of confidence. And when you've loaded the bases twice now, it's going to be a difficult move to, especially for confidence, just to keep everything up. You have to get a strikeout here. You have to get something, even if it's just an out through a line drive, something like that, just to keep the confidence of Ramos high early on in this match.
Yeah, so Bowling Green does have a right-handed arm up in the pen, but Ramos going to stay in the game after an extended meeting at the mound. It will be Sam Seeker, the right fielder, up to bat. Seeker, good day yesterday, 2-for-3, scored a run, drove in one, walked once, coming after an off performance on Friday for him when he went 0-for-3. So bases loaded for Akron, two outs, top of the first here, Akron leading 1-0. This fastball in for Rigo. He'll start ahead of Seeker. Lefty on lefty matchup. Rigo once again working from that stretch. Off speed, misses inside here, 1-1. Now Rigo coming set once again. The pitch to Seeker. This one fouled off to the left side. Rigo from the stretch once again. 1-2-1 the count. And this one swung on and missed. And actually, It was a 1-2 count, so that will be a strikeout to end the inning. Big strikeout for Rego. Get out of the jam. So Akron threatens big time. Bases loaded with two outs. They can only score one, though. So Rego and the Falcons escape with minimal damage, which is a good sign for them early on. Could have been a lot worse. So they'll have a chance to respond here. Bottom of the first when we come back. You're listening to Bowling Green Baseball here on 88.1 WBGU.
To protect her home and family in a disaster, Karen was willing to wade through water, mud, and insurance paperwork.
Yeah, I can do this.
You go, Karen! By simply understanding and updating what her insurance covers and doesn't cover now, she'll be better prepared no matter when disaster strikes. Learn other simple ways to protect your home and family before a natural disaster at ready.gov. That's ready.gov. A message from FEMA and the Ad Council.
I'm probably okay to have one more drink before I drive home. I'm probably okay. I open the window to stay alert.
Probably okay. I just popped some gum in my mouth.
Step out of the car, please.
I probably made a mistake.
Probably okay isn't okay when it comes to drinking and driving. If you see a warning sign, stop and call a cab, a car, or a friend. Buzzed driving is drunk driving. A message brought to you by NHTSA and the Ad Council.
Back here at Stellar Field, Tyler Kavlich, Chaz McNeil with you. And Chaz, let's go through this Bowling Green lineup. It's going to be the same as yesterday. Nathan Archer, the center fielder, will lead us off. Sam Seidel, shortstop, batting second. DJ Newman, designated hitter today, the two-way star, will bat third. Batting cleanup is Tyler Ross. He'll be over at second. Leighton Banjoff will bat fifth. He'll be at third. Jack Krause in right field will bat sixth. TJ Tackett's at first base will bat seventh. Gavin Gannon, who had that huge grand slam bottom of the eighth yesterday, he will bat eighth in left field. And Garrett Wright will round out the batting order for the Falcons. He'll be behind the plate. And the starting pitcher for the Zips will be Spencer Atkins. Leading off. And can you walk us through a little bit of Atkins' season so far, Chaz?
Yes, Atkins, throughout the season, he's the top of the Zips in pitching. Zips are about middle of the MAC in pitching. But overall, his season has been just not what you'd expect. He's thrown 196 pitches in the past two starts. He's 0-2 in games that he is credited with. He's got a 5.91 run ERA. So he lets up some runs, but it's top of his team. He's been at Akron for a while.
So two foul balls here by Archer, down in the count, 0-2. Delivery from the right-hander up high, 1-2. And he's done a good job, though, of not walking batters the past couple of outings. Past two outings for Atkins, he has 12 strikeouts compared to just two walks. The 1-2 delivery, this one lined into right center field. That'll drop for a base hit for Nathan Archer to start the offense for Bowling Green in the bottom of the first. Nice piece of two-strike hitting there by Archer.
Archer, just exactly what you want to start your team off with. There's a reason he's a leadoff. That's a reason he started 116 out of 118 games that he's played. He is just exactly what you'd expect. He's consistent, does not make mistakes, perfect fielding percentage last year, and then at bat, he can just smoke a ball.
Now Sam Seidel up to bat. He's reached base every game this season. I believe if you go back to last season, his on-base streak is around about 28 games. Yes, here's a strike call to start the at-bat for Seidel. 0-1. Archer on first does have four stolen bases on the season. He's also been caught stealing four times. Pitch here by Atkins. Misses outside with the off-speed. 1-1.
Archer taking a healthy lead off of first base.
On the base pass yesterday, they made a decision to really pay close attention to him, threw over multiple times. And as I speak, there's a pickoff attempt. Archer dives in headfirst. But Atkins, as you're saying, he's a guy that can go deep into some outings. Like you said, 196 pitches past two starts combined on the 17th against Northern Illinois. His last start, he threw 110 pitches in 6 2/3 innings, only allowed a run, did give up 6 hits, but allowed just 1 walk, 1 extra base hit, and struck out 8. As leaves this one up high, 2-1. And you look last season, he had a phenomenal outing against Bowling Green on the 17th of last season of March. He pitched a complete game, allowed just 1 run, 3 hits, a walk, struck out 11 Falcons on 111 pitches. So phenomenal outing last time he faced off against this Bowling Green team as he gets Seidel to swing through a high fastball there. 2-2 the count.
Seidel took a hard cut at that ball, but just was not able to make ends meet there.
Atkins, 2-2 delivery. This one fouled off to the left side by Seidel. We'll do it again. Sam Seidel coming into this with a .278 batting average. .383 on base percentage for Seidel. The pitch by the right-hander is inside. Almost hit Sam. Full count, 3-2. DJ Newman on deck for the Falcons. The 3-2 pitch. This one skied to the left side, and it's going to go out of play. So foul ball there. Second straight foul ball on the 3-2 count. We'll do it once again.
Seidel with just 1 hit yesterday in 5 different appearances at the plate.
Seidel awaiting the 3-2 delivery. He skies this one up. We'll see if it stays playable. It's Heyman camping under it. The third baseman makes the catch in foul territory. So Seidel goes down with the pop-up. One out. Here in the bottom of the first, Akron still leading 1-0. Nathan Archer on first base as the designated hitter. Steps up to the plate, DJ Newman. Newman, the two-way star, hailing from Archbold, Ohio. Coming off a phenomenal freshman season, just a sophomore. He'll look at a fastball in the zone for strike one. Last season, Newman named a freshman All-American first team, the MAC freshman pitcher of the year, and was also named first team All-MAC as a designated hitter. Accomplished as a freshman is insane. So look at the ball outside, 1-1. And he's off to another great start this season at the plate, .342 batting average, .684 slugging percentage, leads this Falcons team right now. As he awaits the 1-1 pitch by Atkins. This one in there, 1-2. Newman coming into this series, 3rd in the MAC in runs scored, 6th in home runs and slugging percentage, and 7th in OPS. Atkins, the 1-2 delivery from the stretch. This one fouled off. Nice job by Newman to reach out, make contact with it. He went high and outside with the fastball. Atkins working from the stretch with Archer on first. We'll do it again here on the 1-2 pitch. Atkins delivery. This one a little high. 2-2. Very close. Didn't miss by much, but good tank by Newman.
That one could have been called a strike on any other day, but just missed the batter's box.
DJ had a big day yesterday, 3-for-5 at the plate, drove in 3 runs as he'll swing and miss at an off-speed pitch down and outside. He'll go down swinging. So 2 outs now, bottom of the first. That will lead to Tyler Ross, the cleanup hitter for the Falcons, stepping up to the plate. Archer still at first base. Tyler Ross also a big day yesterday. 3-for-4 at the plate. Scored twice. Drove in a run. Also walked once. As pickoff attempt here to Archer, dives in head first safely.
We talked about this at the opening, Tyler, but this Falcons batting lineup is just so strong. You look at everything. They all have great batting averages. It's so deep. Right in the middle, you have Tyler Ross with a .364 batting average. Started every single game he's played. With 66 at-bats, he's got 7 doubles, 3 triples, and 4 home runs, and he's the RBI king. He's got 17 right now, and he's had big games, big performances. This roster is just so deep when it comes to batting.
And he looked at a fastball first pitch. This one fouled off. Archer was running on that pitch. He'll have to go back to first after the foul off to the right side by Ross. And he mentioned those power numbers. He's already matched last season's home run total in 30 less games played. So he already has had four all of last season. We'll see if Archer decides to go again here. 0-2 count, 2 outs, Atkinson's pitch. This one driven to right field, diving is Seeker, and he made the catch. What a diving play by Sam Seeker to end the inning. Phenomenal catch in right field. So Akron will hold Bowling Green scoreless, maintain a 1-0 lead going into the top of the second. You're listening to Bowling Green Baseball here on 88.1 WBGO.
So I'm a cat, and I just moved in with this new human, and she's got this little toy she's always playing with all day long. Tap, 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 bloop, bloop. She can't put it down. There it is. Oh, and get this. She even talks to it. Last week, she asked it for Chinese, and guess what? Egg rolls showed up like magic. Humans have cool toys.
A person is the best thing to happen to a shelter pet. Be that person. Adopt. Brought to you by the Ad Council and the ShelterPetProject.org.
This is you over 30 years ago.
Are we there yet? Are we there yet?
And this is your mom now.
Are we there yet? Are we there yet?
Roles change without us noticing. That's why AARP gives you the information to provide even better care for your loved one. Visit aarp.org/caregiving. Brought to you by AARP and the Ad Council.
Back here at Stellar Field, Akron holding a 1-0 advantage after the first inning. Archer got on for the Falcons to start off that bottom of the first. He ended up stranded at first after the Falcons were unable to get anything going outside of that. Rigo Ramos still on the mound for Bowling Green. Shaky first inning for Ramos, but he recovered, got out of a big bases loaded jam with 2 outs. So Michael Sprockett, the catcher, will step in to start off the top of the second. Look at a fastball for strike one.
That top of the first was really making the best of a bad situation. Only allowing one run after loading the bases twice, Ramos could have gotten out of that inning a lot worse off.
That one barely missed. Fastball couldn't find the zone. 1-1 the count. Rocket, 0-for-1 yesterday, walked twice, scored once as he checks swings here, but this one's going to be popped over the head of Banjoff at third base. Sprockett's going to get on base on a check swing single. Never fully committed to that, but once again, the ball found the bat. Banjoff dove for that, couldn't get to it. Lucky hit there for Sprockett. Either way, he stands on first base, start off the inning for Akron.
The leaping attempt, it was just a little bit too high for Banjoff, who put good effort into it, just right off the tip of the glove almost.
So Henry Heyman will step up to the plate for Akron. Ramos now working from the stretch, the lefty's delivery in there. So starts off both batters with a strike this inning after dealing with some command issues in the first inning. Henry Henry Heyman played the past two seasons at Barden Community College. Looks at a fastball up here, 1-1. Heyman, the junior infielder, hails from Melbourne, Australia. International player for the Zips.
Familiar with kangaroos.
As this pickoff attempt to get past Hackett's at first, so that will result in Sprocket advancing to second. As the throw in by Tackett skips past Tyler Ross, but Sprocket will stay at second. So it's a bad pickoff attempt there by Ramos. Free base for Sprocket.
You could see frustration from Tackett and Ramos after that. Just both off-the-mark throws that just should not happen early on in this matchup.
Henry Heyman, good day at the plate yesterday. 2-for-3, scored once, drove in. 2 of Akron's 6 runs. Ramos looked back to second. Now delivery. This one fouled back. 1-2 the count. So Akron already with a runner in scoring position. No outs here. Top of the second. They've now threatened in both these innings to start this one. Looking to avoid a sweep against the Falcons. The delivery by the left-hander, left up with the fastball, 2-2.
Falcons wanting the sweep very badly. Like I said before, history in the making here. First time since 2008 if they get the sweep going.
And that 2008 three-series sweep against MAC teams happened with the last sweep coming against Akron. So looking to repeat a little bit of history are the Falcons as another pitch misses high once again. So Ramos just missing high on these pitches. You would have to think just not finishing correctly on his release. Another fastball misses up high. So 3-2 count, Henry Heyman. No out still here, top of the second. Heyman hits this one hard left field. That's going to slice foul, though. Had good distance on it. Went foul far out of play, though. Looking to strain it up. We'll do full count once again.
It was a deep shot.
We'll see if Ramos tries to change speeds, change eye level here, stick with the same approach. Ramos from the stretch comes set. Give a look back to Sprocket at second. Now go to the plate. Fastball misses low. So there's the fourth walk of the game allowed by Rigo Ramos.
It's another full count walk. We've seen this a couple times with Ramos in this game where he gets right to the edge of getting a strikeout and just cannot end up closing the possession.
So Rigo now up to 16 walks on the season and 14 innings pitched. Not the numbers that you want to hear command-wise. So we'll go back up to the top of the order for Akron, Evan Batone. He walked his first time, came around to score. Pickoff attempt here to second. Good stop by Ross. The throw was in the dirt. Ross went down to a knee to stop it, prevent it from going in the outfield grass. So runners first and second for Akron. Nobody out. Top of the second. Evan Batone, the leadoff hitter for the Zips, up to bat. He scored the only run of the game so far. The pitch here left up high. Batone showed bunt. And it looked like Heyman was faking a steal attempt there. Interesting because Sprocket wasn't doing anything at second. So not sure how much that decoy actually worked.
We're seeing a lot of aggression, though, from Akron.
And we'll see if Evan Batone tries to do another bunt here. Show it. He will show it. The pitch by Ramos laid down to Ramos. Ramos, no play at second or third. Will go to first for the out. So Bowling Green gets an out. But Akron advances runners to second and third.
And with the walk issues that Ramos is having right now, that was the best move that Akron could have made. Bunt, buying enough time for two runners to get in threatening position, and now you're just one miscue, one walk away from having loaded bases.
And now we'll have another meeting at the mound. And Kyle Halleck, BJ's head coach, going to make a pitching change here. So Rigo Ramos' day is done after 1 1/3 innings pitch. So we'll take a quick break, preview the relief pitcher in the game for Bowling Green, taking Rigo Ramos' spot. And we'll see if Akron can capitalize on the second and third opportunity with one out. You are listening to Bowling Green Baseball here on 88.1 WBGU.
I'm a 40-year-old man that walked in there to get his high school diploma. It was very hard for me, but Ms. Araceli, she gave me direction.
At age 47, Marco finished his high school diploma.
50% of getting your high school diploma is walking through those doors. The other 50% is doing the work.
No one gets a diploma alone. If you're thinking of finishing your high school diploma, you have help. Find free adult education classes near you at finishyourdiploma.org. That's finishyourdiploma.org. Brought to you by the Dollar General Literacy Foundation and the Ad Council.
A ranger station.
I'd like to report a bear hug.
Okay.
I put out my campfire and Smokey Bear hugged me.
So you drowned the fire, you stirred it, drowned it again, and felt that it was cold?
Uh-huh.
Yep, he's just letting you know you did good.
Bear hug from Smokey Bear. Status update.
I'm gonna let you go now. There are many ways to start a fire, but one sure way to put it out. Learn how you can do your part at SmokeyBear.com.
Sponsored by the U.S. Forest Service, Ad Council, and your state forester.
So coming into a relief for Rigo Ramos, the Sunday starter today, will be Calvin Mitchell, who started the first three Sundays of the season for Bowling Green. Sophomore right-hander out of Brecksville, Ohio. Went to Brecksville Broadview Heights High School. This is his first season in the orange and brown. Played last season at Wright State. This season, this will be his sixth appearance, third out of the bullpen. 1-2 record on the season, 11.32 ERA. He's pitched 10 and a third innings, walked six while striking out nine. And he's a guy that earned the starting job for the Sunday spot at the start of the season. Had good control throughout most of the off season, really demonstrated that control. Had a few shaky starts in his second and third ones. So Rigo Ramos was taking over that duty as the Sunday starter, but it'll be Mitchell who will come in to substitute him. We'll hold off on Rigo Ramos' final line. He still has two runs out there that could be accounted for him. So Nicky Sackett will step up to the plate. Sackett hit by a pitch and stole base. His first time up. Off-speed pitch by Mitchell in there for a strike. Mitchell working from the stretch. The right-hander comes set. Delivery to Sackett. This one drilled to left field, but fairly deep. Ganon will settle under it. So advancing home will be Sprocket. Ganon really never had a chance on him. The throw-in was not good enough to get the relay going. So Sprocket will score on the sack fly by Nicky Sackett.
A great catch by Banjoff, though, with the throw-in from Ganon into the hand of Banjoff. He caught it almost to the side. It was a great catch, but just not enough time to take it home.
And Henry Heyman will stay at second as Max Bowman will step up to the plate. Heyman not advancing on that flyout. First pitch by Mitchell down and low in the dirt outside for a ball. Bowman walked in his first at-bat. He also stole a base. He was part of that double steal with Sackett in the top of the first. Mitchell looked back to Heyman at second. Delivery here outside to Bowman. So 2-0 start in this at-bat. Bowman coming into this game batting .288 on the season. .466 slugging percentage. He has pop in the bat. looks at another ball outside on the off speed. So 3-0 start here by Mitchell.
This could be an opportunity for Mitchell, like you said. Ramos took over that starting spot. They're fighting for that Sunday job, and now you've got Mitchell who has the opportunity to kind of clean up the mess that Ramos set.
Mitchell throws in a strike, 3-1. This has been a big problem for relievers for Bowling Green, just locating that strike zone consistently. Too many balls thrown out of the bullpen early on in this season. They're still looking for those high-leverage guys to pop up. For Mitchell, though, he'll be a guy that they're going to need to eat innings here today. As this one skied up into the air, Tackett's moving in foul territory. It will stay in play. He'll make the catch. So that will end the inning. So once again, Akron threatens. They do come across the score one run, but Mitchell comes in, closes, locks down, doesn't really allow too much damage as could have been done. So Akron, early 2-0 lead. We will go to the bottom of the second. Bowling Green will try to respond. You're listening to Falcon Baseball here on 88.1 WBGU.
Long ago, you wouldn't think of galloping on a horse while doing calligraphy, and you wouldn't have attempted to ride your bike while typing a letter. Yet you think you can safely operate a multi-ton vehicle while texting? Behind the wheel is no place to multitask. If you want to BRB, drive now and text later. Lives depend on it.
Visit StopTextStopWrecks.org, a message brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, Project Yellow Light, Noise, and the Ad Council.
The Western Scrub Jay. I was taking my science class on a virtual reality bird watching expedition. All of a sudden, Charlie Kane shouts, "Arr! Arr!" He had spotted the elusive black swift, a bird rarely seen in the wild. For a brief moment, Charlie had not the eyes of a 9-year-old boy. He had the eyes of an eagle.
Teachers just have better work stories. Find out how creative teaching can be at teachdfw.org. Brought to you by Teach and the Ad Council.
Back here at Stellar Field, Rigo Ramos's day is done, so we can officially announce his final line. The one thing we can't announce is the decision. He is in line currently for a loss if the score were to hold the way it is right now, but he threw 41 pitches, went an inning in a third, faced 10 batters, hit a batter, walked four, struck out one, let up one hit, and allowed two runs, both of which were earned. So it will still be Atkins in there on the mound for Akron. Throws in a strike to start off Banjoff. Banjoff, Krause, Tackett's 5-6-7, due up for Bowling Green, top of the second. As this one lined out to center field. Coming in will be Batone. He'll make the catch with his hat flying off his head.
Just a hard shot right to the center. And you could see Batone reaching for it, going at it, and it was just in the right spot for him. And just not the right place when you want if you're the Falcons.
The right fielder, Jack.
So Jack Krause will step up to the plate. Krause yesterday, big day. 2-for-3 at the plate. Looks at a ball inside in the dirt for ball one. Krause 2-for-3 at the plate. Scored twice. Drove in two runs. Launched a home run. So look at another ball. Start this count off 2-0. On Friday, Krause went 1-for-4. Scored a run, drove in another run. So productive weekend so far for Jack Krause. As now he'll finally look in a strike. Outside corner caught there by Atkins.
And if you're Akron, this is exactly what you want. You're forcing hits to easy positions. You're scoring early. And the Falcons are going to swing. You know that. That's how their offense functions. They will swing at anything that moves. But they usually get a lot of production out of that. Right now, Akron is just kind of limiting what they can do. The fielding has been very solid so far.
This one fouled off by Krause. Next pitch bounces behind Sprocket for a ball. Full count. And Bowling Green has not been the best when they allow opponents to score first. They're 8-3. When they do score, they are 8-3 after these two wins when they score first. However, when their opponent scores first, BG just 2-5 this season. They'll look to change that narrative here today. Krause looks at a ball up, so Krause gets on base with a walk, one out. That is just the first walk allowed by Atkins here today.
Atkins just having a very solid day so far. One walk, one strikeout, and only one hit allowed. Like we said before, with this Falcons team, that's not always something that's going to be guaranteed.
TJ Tackett's the first baseman, steps into the batter's box. Lefty on righty matchup. Tackett's the lefty, Atkins the righty. Looks at a strike there to start the at-bat. This is Tackett's first at-bat of the day. As he'll swing at this one, line it down left side, but that'll go foul.
Atkins, the local product from Sylvania, Ohio, just about 30 minutes north from here. So it's a little bit of a homecoming for him.
And like we mentioned, pitched really well. Really well might even be an understatement against these Falcons last year. Looking to have a start comparable to that.
You never know, might have some family in the crowd, something like that. Give you a little boost to your arm.
Leaves this one up high, 1-2 the count. Tackett's starting to try to solidify that first base role for Bowling Green. He was a two-way guy in high school, pitched and hit. So look at a ball down here. He was a perfect game preseason All-American in his senior year at high school. In his junior season at Perrysburg, he had a 375 batting average and a 257 ERA. That's the 2-2 pitch here, fouled off to the left side once again by Tackett's. And he's got Mid-American Conference roots, does TJ Tackett's. His dad played baseball at Toledo, and his mother played basketball for the Rockets.
A little rivalry there.
Must be interesting at Thanksgiving dinners as he'll look at a pitch down the middle here for strike three, caught looking. So two down now, bottom of the second for Bowling Green. Second strikeout for Atkins. First strikeout looking for the right-hander. Gavin Gannon, like we mentioned, that grand slam, bottom of the eighth, last game he'll step up to bat. Gannon on the day yesterday, 2-4-3, drove in four runs, scored once. He'll look at a fastball that catches the outside corner for a strike. And he's been productive all weekend long. Friday, no slouch of performance either. 2-4, scored once, drove in a run. Has struck out once in both these contests this weekend as he'll look at a pinch that catches the zone once again. Down 0-2 in the count.
Good on really the game saver yesterday with that grand slam. Not every athlete can produce in a moment where there's so much on the line. Scores very tight, but Gannon with a clutch move to put the Falcons ahead.
The 0-2 pitch by Atkins left up high with the fastball, so three straight fastballs to start off Gannon. We'll see if he tries to change eye levels after going up high or if he decides to go with the heat once again. Jack Krause on first for the Falcons. Dancing on the base passes. Gannon caught looking. Fastball catches the zone. Four straight fastballs to Gannon. Sets him down. Spencer Atkins finishes off the inning with two straight strikeouts, both looking. So Akron holds that 2-0 advantage going to the top of the third. You're listening to Bowling Green Falcons Baseball here on 88.1 WBGU.
I'm Surgeon General Jerome Adams. If you've recovered from COVID-19 confirmed by a positive test, you're in a special position to help us fight the virus. Your plasma has antibodies that may help others fight COVID. So please donate plasma now. You can literally help save lives. There are locations across the country that have safe ways for you to donate. Find a site to donate your plasma at coronavirus.gov.
Produced by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services at taxpayer expense.
All right, back here at Stella Field, Tyler Cavlitz along with Chaz McNeil. And Chaz, continuing on a tradition started by Reese Landon, who broadcast the majority of the baseball games for Bowling Green the past couple of seasons. Trivia, which he introduced, and continue that on this season. So today's question, we'll reveal the question here top of the third, and then we'll reveal the answer top of the fifth, give you guys a little bit of time to think about it. Try to do it without looking it up, make it a little bit of fun. But the trivia question is, who holds the MLB record for most walk-off home runs? Your options, Chaz, and our listeners at home, is either A, Barry Bonds, B, Jim Thome, C, Babe Ruth, or D, Albert Pujols. So once again, who holds the MLB record for most walk-off home runs? Is it A, Barry Bonds, B, Jim Thome, C, Babe Ruth, or D, Albert Pujols? Any initial thoughts on that one?
I'm going to be honest with you. You got the three big names. You got Pujols, you've got Bonds, and then what was that other one? What was the third option?
Pujols, Bonds, and then Babe Ruth and Jim Thome.
Yeah, you've got Babe Ruth, you got Thome also. I just, you know, you hear Barry Bonds, you think of all of those records, but then Pujols has had...
He's had a lot of big hits in his career.
And you can never count out Babe Ruth. I'm going to be honest. And then there's that second name that, at least to me, a little bit less known. So, you know, you might want to...
He also had some big hits in the 90s with the then Indians of Cleveland, had some big hits in the World Series, ALCSs in 95, 97, all those magical years for the Cleveland baseball team, we'll call them. As Mitchell starts off with a strike here to Patone, and then he drills one left side that just goes foul. And pardon me, that's Lafferty, not Patone. So fourth in the lineup. So Lafferty, Schebler, Cavey, 4-5-6 for Akron. 0-2 pitch here by Mitchell. Misses outside with the slider in the dirt. Count goes to 1-2. So once again, we'll reveal that answer for the trivia question top of the fifth. Give you guys a little more time to think that one through. And now off speed, can't catch the corner. Count goes even at 2-2. Lafferty popped out to short. His first time up, it was an infield fly with the bases loaded at that point. He'll lead off this inning. Akron up 2-0. Pitch by Mitchell. Barely misses. Just a tad low on that. Count runs full. Mitchell has allowed a walk in his two-thirds of an inning so far. And this one catches the outside corner. Lafferty is ready to run down the first. He'll go to the dugout instead. Fastball catches the corner for a strikeout by Mitchell. Dotted that line on the outside.
Lafferty thought he had the go-ahead there, but just a little bit lower than he expected.
And that was a great frame there by Garrett Wright behind the plate. Pull that one in just a bit. So now Charlie Schebler into bat. Thinks about swinging at this one. Holds back. It's a strike either way on the outside corner. 0-1 the count. Schebler, the DH, flew out to right field. His first time up. The lefty awaits the pitch from the righty. Mitchell's pitch. Big swing here by Schebler. Can't connect on the off speed. Down 0-2.
And this is what you want if you're the Falcons. You want some quick outs. You want some slicing right down the middle and just catching Akron off guard a little bit.
Pitch by Mitchell. Schebler thought about it. This off speed in the dirt. Yeah, and if you're Mitchell, you really want that quick inning, like you said. Just get some momentum going. Akron's had all the momentum the first two innings. Get your offense back up to bat. See if they can put together some hits. The 1-2 pitch. This one barely misses once again on the off speed. He's been close with that slider a few times now. Slider, curveball. So, 2-2. Delivery by Mitchell. This one grounded to first. Tackett will field it cleanly. He'll take it himself. Two outs early here. Top of the third. Mitchell starting to find some rhythm.
And that was sort of an issue that happened with Ramos was he fell behind early, bases loaded, kind of pitching a little bit more conservatively, not putting it right down the middle to risk those easy base hits. But right now with Mitchell, you're kind of open. You've got two outs. You can allow a little bit more freedom, pitch a little bit tighter if you want, or looser, I mean, but still just allowing that freedom is massive for the Falcons.
Braden Cavey steps up to the plate. Mitchell gets ahead of him with a fastball down the middle. Mitchell's done a good job this inning of getting ahead of these Akron batters. Mitchell goes with another strike there. Swing and a miss by Cavey. Looks like he took a little something off of it. Possible changeup there. Cavey swung right over the top of it. So another 0-2 count here by Mitchell. Looking to finish this off for a quick inning. The 0-2 delivery by Mitchell, off speed, just misses, 1-2.
Mitchell having some close calls here early, just very decisive strikes or balls.
So Mitchell once again working from the lineup, wind up the 1-2 delivery. This one grounded over to Banjoff at third. He'll field it cleanly, throw over to Tackett's. 1-2-3 inning for Calvin Mitchell. We'll go to the bottom of the third. Falcons trying to get some offense going. Akron leads 2-0 after the top of the third. You're listening to Bowling Green Baseball here on 88.1 WBGU. Don't go anywhere.
Jill, why don't you tell the class what you did this weekend?
Well, my dad and I went in search of some magical minnows and found a zillion of them in the stream from our lookout rock. Then my sister and I escaped from an evil slug king and went back to my super twig fort for safety. Then we told stories till it got dark, and the Big Dipper led us all the way home.
Wow.
Where were you, Jill?
We went to the forest. It's not that far away.
Ask your parents to take you and your friends to the forest this week. It's closer than you think. Check out discovertheforest.org. Brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service and the Ad Council.
I'm a wife,
a sister,
and a grandfather.
I'm an office clerk.
I'm a research analyst,
dance fitness instructor,
actor.
I'm a copywriter.
I'm a veteran.
I have lupus,
cerebral palsy.
I'm blind.
And I'm working in a job I love.
I love.
Because I was given a chance
to contribute my skills and talents.
To show that my disability
is only one part of who I am.
Who I am.
Who I am.
At work, it's what people can do that matters.
For more information, visit whatcanyoudocampaign.org.
Back here at Stellar Field, Bowling Green finally reached the bottom of the order with Garrett Wright. After him, we'll go back to the top with Archer and Seidel. Atkins has been clean so far. He's allowed just one hit in two innings. He's racked up three strikeouts, walked just one batter. So Garrett Wright will step up to the plate right on the season, producing well so far. .310 batting average at the plate. First pitch swing. This one lofted out to right field. Coming in is Sam Seeker. He'll camp under it, make the running catch. So Wright is down after one pitch. One pitch, one out for Atkins.
If the Falcons want to win this game, one of the keys they have to do is they have to put the game into their control. For the first two innings, the Zips have just owned the momentum. They've owned the speed. They've had a majority of the time during their possessions at bat. And I think if you're the Falcons, you're just trying to create too much offensive efficiency. And if you slow things down, take over the game like they've done before, taking a lot of time up scoring runs and just slowing things down, they'll be a lot more productive.
So Nathan Archer looks at a strike there to start the at-bat, 0-1. Atkins working from the windup. The delivery's fouled off behind us. So 0-2 early for Archer. Nathan Archer earned a spot second team All-MAC and the All-Defensive teams the last season. One of the best fielders in the MAC. Looks at a ball inside here, 1-2. And Nathan Archer had a 7-game hitting streak come to an end on Friday. He's actually gone hitless this series so far. 0-for-9 at the plate. As he'll look at another ball here. He has struck out just once, hasn't drawn a walk though, scored twice. And he has driven in 2 RBI this weekend. So, 2-2 pitch by Atkins. Swinging is Archer, chops it over to Bowman at second, mishandles it in the glove. Archer going to beat it out. So, fielded cleanly by Bowman, just couldn't find a way to get it out of his glove in time. By the time he made the throw, Archer had blazed down to first base.
And that one bounced off the turf as well, just unable to get another. We've seen this with both sides, just unable to get a throw straight and quick. There's been those just quick little easy mistakes that have cost big possessions on both sides.
Yeah, just give me a second. So this will be now stepping up Sam Seidel. Pick over to first, so we'll take a quick 10-second break here for station identification. Get back to the at-bat then with Sam Seidel.
This is Artie Abrego, and you're listening to 88.1 FM WBGU Bowling Green, home of the Falcon Media Sports Network.
Back here, pitch to Seidel, left high, so 1-0, and that was ruled a single for Nathan Archer, so infield single. Give him 2 hits on the day after going 0-for-9 in the first 2 games of the series. Sam Seidel popped out to third base, his first time up to bat in foul territory. Pick off to Archer, that making sure to keep attention with him all weekend long. Running out of fingers to count the amount of times that they've attempted to pick him off at first. Have not been successful so far.
Archer, one of those tone guys where if you let him get hot, the rest of the team will get hot. So they're making sure to keep him tamped down in the series.
Archer stays at first. Fastball misses outside to Seidel. 2-0. We did see Archer attempt to steal in the first, but it was on a foul ball by Seidel. We'll see if he decides to run here. 4-for-8 on stolen bases on the season. He stays as fastball catches the outside corner to Seidel. Sam Seidel bats lefty, throws right. The sophomore infielder from Greenwich, Ohio. Another pickoff attempt over to first with Archer. Seidel last season led the MAC and the Falcons with 8 sacrifice hits. He has speed if he can get on. Seidel with 16 stolen bases led the Falcons last season. He's reached base every game this season. As he looks at a fastball that catches the inside zone. Seidel had to back up on that, but umpire says that it catches the zone. Steve Miller behind the plate today. Umpires today, Steve Miller first behind the plate at first base. It's Craig McCarty. And at third, Aaron Woodbury. This one chopped by Seidel. It'll be foul. So we'll do it again, 2-2. From the stretch now is Atkins, the 2-2 delivery. This one swung on and lined over the head of Sackett at short. Archer will make a hard turn around second, but he'll stay put. Solid line drive single there by Sam Seidel. Gives the Falcons runners on first and second with just 1 out here in the bottom of the third.
Sackett leaping for that, nowhere near him. And that one fielded by Batone and just unable to get anything done. Honestly, Archer probably could have gone to third. It would have been very close. But with how that ball traveled through the air, it might have been done.
That one was starched by Seidel, hitting that outfield grass pretty quickly. So DJ Newman, the two-way star, as the designated hitter today, up to bat. Looks at a fastball for a strike. Newman went down swinging his first time up in the bottom of the first. Falcons with back-to-back hits today for the first time against Atkins. Seidel at first, Newman at second. apologies, Newman batting. It's Archer at second as the fastball to Newman's on the outside, so 1-1 the count. The pitch count for Atkins up over 50 now. The right-hander delivers outside in the dirt. 2-1. So his control is starting to waver a little bit here in this third inning. Not as strong with the command as he was in the first two frames. Newman awaits the pitch. This one left high. So 3-1 count against DJ Newman. Newman this season has drawn 14 walks. He's struck out now 22 times after a strikeout in the first. A 4.46 on base percentage for the sophomore of the season. Big cut here on the 3-1 pitch. Can't connect. Count goes to 3-2. That 4.46 on base percentage, third on the team, probably second. Not sure if TJ Tackett has enough qualified at-bats, but behind him and Tyler Ross. So the full count, 3-2 pitch to Newman. Newman just got caught there. Didn't really make a step. Foot stuck in mud. Swung the bat of the head, or the head of the bat at the ball on the outside. Caught swinging for the second time here today. Good pitch by Atkins to get him chasing out of the zone for the second out of the inning. Really just got caught in between there. Looked like he decided to swing late. Just threw the head of the bat at it, hoping for the best. He goes down swinging. Tyler Ross will step up to bat. He swings first pitch, hits this one deep left field. Going back is Lafferty. This one over the wall. Tyler Ross connects on the first pitch with a 3-run home run. Puts the Falcons up 3-2, bottom of the third.
Home run number 5 of the season.
Ross with his 5th of the year. And in a moment where the Falcons needed it, you have 2 on base, and just like that, like I said, Falcons take the lead right back, and you just have to, they're playing the game in their own style. They're getting those home runs, those big hits, and you could see the arm of Atkins just kind of wearing down, creating those opportunities.
So Atkins looked pretty unhittable for those first two innings. Cracks have shown in the third inning. His pitch count now at 58, and Tyler Ross takes him deep over the left field fence for 3 runs. Now Banjoff up to bat. This one popped up behind the plate. Going back is Sprockett. That's actually going to land about 5 feet in front of us to the left in the stands. So 0-1 will be the count. But how about Tyler Ross? The tear that he is on right now on Friday. 1-for-3 at the plate. Drove in a run. Yesterday, 3-for-4 at the plate, drove in another run, scored twice. Yesterday, he had a triple, a double, and today starts off with that 3-run bomb after going down his first at-bat. And Ross already has a MAC Player of the Week award on March 11th. Wouldn't be surprised if he adds another one or two by the time this season is up and done. 0-2 count now on Banjoff, and he's caught swinging on the off-speed pitch. So that'll do it for the bottom of the third. Atkins gets the strikeout to end it, but Tyler Ross connects on a 3-run bomb, putting the Falcons up 3-2 after 3 frames. You are listening to Bowling Green Baseball here on 88.1 WBGU.
Eating, working, living pain-free. These are a few of the things many of us take for granted. But for many adults with disabilities who are elderly or have serious medical issues, dental care is simply unaffordable. Dental Lifeline Network is looking for dentists who can change this. DLN is asking dentists and their teams to volunteer to just see one of the many patients in need. You can literally change a life. Visit willyouseeone.org to help change one life in your community today.
My name is Jim. I'm a veteran, and I lost both legs in Vietnam. My victory was proving that a disability is not a limitation.
I'm Julius. I'm a veteran. My victory was going from homeless to home.
At DAV, we're on a mission
helping veterans of all generations get the benefits they've earned.
I'm Cece. My victory was finishing my education.
When America's veterans win, we all win. Help us support more victories for veterans. Go to DAV.org.
Back here at Stellar Field, moving to the top of the fourth. Calvin Mitchell still out on the mound, but Tyler Ross putting the Falcons up 3-2 with a three-run bomb over the left field fence, bottom half of last inning. And while we're still going to wait and hold off to reveal that answer for the trivia question, we do have some baseball history to go over for today. So on this day in 1961, the New York State Senate approved $55 million in funding for a new stadium located at Flushing Meadows Park in Queens, New York. That stadium would go on to be called Shea Stadium, where the New York Mets would play from 1964 to 2008 before moving to Citi Field. So kind of cool touch there on this day that got approved. Shea Stadium, one of the historic stadiums in the history of Major League Baseball. So Mitchell starts off, Sam Seeker with a strike. And this one can't catch the outside corner. 1-1 the count. Mitchell has done a good job in relief so far for Rigo Ramos, who struggled, went just 1 3 innings. This one hit out pretty deep to right field. Wind going to knock it down, though. And settling under it will be Jack Krause. That one had a little too much air under it to go any further. Fairly deep right field. Jack Krause puts it away for the first out of the inning.
Wind took that one for a ride. You could see Krause adjusting and then readjusting, trying to just fall under this ball, but the wind was just carrying it at a weird angle.
It looked good when it got hit.
The journey of 1,000 miles begins with the first step. At Children International, we know that the journey to end poverty for good begins first with a child. It starts with their first checkup, lesson, opportunity, job. That journey takes commitment from people like you and me to end poverty for good. Learn more at children.org.
We depend on our drinking water supply daily, but where does that water come from? Your water provider encourages you to get to know your local water source so together we can protect and preserve it. The investments we make as a community to protect our water source now ensure we have a sustainable drinking water supply for the future. Visit drinktap.org to learn more. This message is brought to you by the American Water Works Association and your local water provider.
Connection issues there for a second. Back here, Stellar Field, 1-2 count. Mitchell has on Michael Sprockett. This one fouled off. We'll do it again at 1-2. Sprockett singled his first time up to bat. Ended up advancing to second on a throwing error by Rigo Ramos attempting a pickoff. And he'll ground this one foul on the right side. He ended up coming around to score for the second run of the game for the Zips. Sprockett this season entering today with a batting average under the Mendoza line, 182 coming into this contest. He struggled at the plate. Tally just 6 hits in 33 at-bats, just one of those being an extra base hit so far this season. The pitch by Mitchell misses down and inside, 2-2.
Sprockett only 2 hits on the season so far.
As Mitchell working from that windup once again. Comes set, the windup, the 2-2 delivery. This one skied up and foul to the left side. Mitchell's pitch count up over 25 now. He's a guy that can go deep into the game, as we mentioned, started as the Sunday starter this season for the first 3 weeks of this year's campaign. 2-2 delivery once again. This one hit out to right center field. Coming in is Nathan Archer. He'll call off Jack Krause and make the catch for the second out. So once again, the wind kind of knocking that one down kind of mid-range in the outfield, not really shallow, not deep. That wind blowing heavy to the left. Anything hit to right field right now is going to get knocked down, going to be hard to get one into the gap or over the fence behind the scoreboard over there.
You're seeing these deep, hard shots taken, but you're right, the wind's just sucking it back in, making them more mid-range than long-range. And it, right now it's playing into the Falcons' favor, but Falcons do have a home run on the night.
That was to left field where that wind's pushing, and we've had these winds all weekend now. Interestingly, the wind was going to the right yesterday. It's been going to the left 2 out of the 3 days. As Mitchell starts off Henry Heyman with a strike. Heyman drills a grounder left side but foul. So down 0-2 in the count early. Mitchell looking for his second straight 1-2-3 inning.
This would be huge for Mitchell.
Mitchell has sent down every batter he's faced so far. Gets a sword strikeout there. Henry Heyman caught in between on the off-speed pitch. Calvin Mitchell gets the strikeout to end the inning. Back-to-back 1-2-3 innings for the right-hander. Bowling Green maintains that 3-2 advantage going to the bottom of the fourth. You're listening to Falcon Baseball here on 88.1 WBGU.
Every year, millions of Americans use opioids to manage pain. And reliance on opioids has led to the worst drug crisis in American history. That's why the CDC recommends safer alternatives, like physical therapy, to manage pain. Physical therapists treat pain through movement, hands-on care, and patient education. No warning labels required. When it comes to your health, you have a choice. Choose physical therapy. Visit moveforwardpt.com to find a physical therapist in your area.
Hi, everybody. I'm Jack Hanna. Since I was a boy, I've been fascinated with animals, especially their tireless work ethic. Just look at birds who gather supplies to build nests, or penguins who travel up to 500 miles to secure food for their families. This work ethic is shared by our best friends, canines who perform life-saving work every day. Dogs comfort returning veterans. They work with diabetics, alerting them when there's a change in their blood chemistry. Working dogs are valuable in many ways. So please join me, an American Humane, in supporting our heroic working dogs. Go to AmericanHumane.org to learn more.
So back here at Stellar Field, Tyler Cavalitz along with Chaz McNeil up in the broadcast booth. Jack Krause, TJ Tackett's, Gavin Ganun, and then to the bottom of the order, if we get there, Garrett Wright for the Falcons due up. Krause, first time up in the bottom of the second, walked, was not able to advance. Tackett's and Ganun striking up, both looking to end that second inning. So Jack Krause, the reigning MAC player of the week, digs in the batter's box. This one almost hits him. Fastball down and inside for ball one. And Krause has some family lineage with baseball. His father, Andy, was drafted by the Oakland A's. And so swinging and miss at a fastball here. Count goes even 1-1. Krause in his fifth season at Bowling Green, the senior outfielder from Brighton, Michigan. A 1-1 pitch from Atkins here, left up high and outside, 2-1. Krause, another one of those guys that's really improved this season. A 153 batting average last season, coming into this contest with a 369 batting average on the season, as he'll foul off a ball to the left side. Count runs even. And we're going through that off air, just the amount of hitters on this Bowling Green team that have made huge strides so far this season. As now here's a half swing, which is grounded to third base. Henry Heyman comes up with it, throws it over to Cavey for the out. So that's the second time this game we've seen somebody half swing at it. Akron got a hit out of it. Krause not as lucky. Grounds out to third. Got caught in between. Results in the first out of the inning.
The positioning on that was off. You're right. We saw that with Akron a little bit earlier in the game, but it was just almost a perfect matchup. The ball bounced in the correct way, and BG was not as lucky, and that one just went into the hands of Sackett.
So TJ Tackett's, the lefty, will step in, fouls this one back on the first pitch. Atkins' pitch count now in the upper 60s. Like we've mentioned earlier in this broadcast, he's a guy that will go deep into games, though. So he still possibly has a few more innings left in him. Is this one lined into left field? There's a base hit for TJ Tackett. Just slice that one over Sackett's head into that left field grass.
Tackett
will get on base for the Falcons.
Tackett's thought about going for two there, rounding the base, but just kind of bit it a little bit too soon, and I think that was a good decision as Bowman, or my apologies, as Sackett got it right before.
Yeah, and you'll see that a lot of times, those guys being aggressive, just sometimes trying to just force a miss throw, try to have the illusion that they're really threatening to go to second.
We've seen Akron be aggressive throughout this game so far. And
they're not a team that's been very aggressive on the base path this season. As there's a ball to Gavin Gannon to start his at-bat. Second pitch swinging, skies this one up over to the left side. Multiple Akron zips going over there. It's going to be Sackett who calls off Heyman, it appears. So the shortstop calls off the third baseman, makes the catch for the second out.
Almost looked like a miscommunication between Heyman and Sackett. Heyman looking up at it, almost tried to feel it, but just could not. It seemed like Sackett just was pursuing that ball the entire way through.
When as the shortstop, you're really the center fielder of the infield. If you're over there and call other people off, it'll be the shortstop's ball to get. As this one fouled back over our heads by Garrett Wright to start his at-bat. He flew out to right field, first time up, last inning. Falcons took him three innings to get through the whole order. As here's a fastball in the dirt, running to second. And getting in there safely is TJ Tackett. Good read by Tackett. Saw the ball in the dirt. Saw Sprockett mishandling it initially. Took off towards second. And he gets into scoring position with two outs. So the count 1-1. And that will be scored a wild pitch by Atkins. That one in the dirt. So wild pitch by Spencer Atkins. The delivery here to right. It's fouled off to the right side. So 1-2 the count. Right looking to get some two-out offense going. 310 batting average coming into this game. He has 10 ribbies on the season. Looking for another one here. Right dribbles this one over to short. Up with it is Sackett. He'll go over to KB, end of the inning. So Bowling Green gets another runner into scoring position. Can't do anything with it with two outs, though. Score still stands 3-2. We'll have the reveal of that trivia question we asked a few innings ago when we come back in the top of the fifth. You're listening to Bowling Green Falcons Baseball here on 88.1 WBGU.
Crooked teeth may embarrass kids whose families can't afford braces, and trying to fix their teeth themselves can make things worse. Luckily, there's Donated Orthodontic Services, a program from the American Association of Orthodontists. For children and teens who qualify and are matched with a volunteer orthodontist, treatment can be life-changing and help them smile with confidence. Learn more at aaoinfo.org.
Back here at Stellar Field. So we did ask a trivia question at the top of the third. Who has the most walk-off home runs in MLB history? Our options for my broadcast partner, Chaz McNeil, and our listeners was either A, Barry Bonds, B, Jim Thome, C, Babe Ruth, or D, Albert Pujols. Do you have an answer, Chaz?
I've sat on that a little bit. I think records are always going to be broken. In terms of recency, I'm going to go Pujols. Is it Pujols?
It is not Pujols. Do you have a second guess? I'm going to give you a redemption guess. So your remaining options are Barry Bonds, Jim Thome, Babe Ruth. Pujols was a good guess.
You know, I think I think you threw Tomey in there. I think it's Tomey.
It is, yeah. Jim Tomey. Jim Tomey, 13 walk-off home runs in his career. And interestingly, his 500th home run was also a walk-off home run. So if you want to do some research, see how many times that has happened. Can't imagine it's many. But, yeah, so Jim Tomey, 13 walk-off home runs, the most in MLB history. Key part of that insane Cleveland Indians 90s offense that got them to the World Series twice in 95, 97. Of course, losing to the Braves in 95 and then the Marlins in 97. That World Series drought stretching all the way back to 1948 for Cleveland. So back underway now. Top of the order for Akron, Evan Batone. Looks at a first pitch strike by Calvin Mitchell. Mitchell has not allowed a hit yet out of the bullpen, and there's the first one. It's going to be hit back up to him. Not sure if it caught Mitchell or if it went off his glove. I think it went off his glove. That one hit right back up to Mitchell. Scorcher by Evan Batone. Mitchell just put up the glove in self-defense, deflected off of it. No one had a chance to make a play on the center fielder.
That one looked like it might have hit the shoulder of Mitchell.
Yeah, it hit right up in that region. In fact, nobody has come out and leads me to believe it's probably off the glove. Either way, that'll be an infield single for Batone as a strike thrown in there to start the at-bat to Nicky Sackett. Sackett, a graduate of my alum, still at Monroe Falls High School. Freshman here for the Akron Zips as he looks at a ball, evens count 1-1. And Sackett has struggled on Friday, 0-3, went 2-5. Yesterday, pickoff attempt to Batone at first. He dives in head first, safe. So if you look at now the past seven games for Nicky Sackett, he has four multi-hit performances in those seven games. So he's been on a good streak recently as this one foul tip to the back. Batone was going to second off the contact. He'll go back to first. Count will be 1-2 on the Akron shortstop. He was hit by a pitch his first time up to bat. Interestingly, his seventh time being hit by a pitch this season as he swings and misses on the off-speed outside. Mitchell got him to chase. Chalk that down now as the third strikeout out of the pen by Calvin Mitchell. Good pitch to get him to reach out of the zone. So one out now here in the top of the fifth. Max Bowman, the second baseman, will step up to bat. He's walked, stole a base, and popped out to first so far. Running is Batone. The throw by Wright, and they got him in plenty of time. Looks like Batone lost his footing going in towards second. Really awkward slide, but that throw beat him regardless. Great throw by Garrett Wright to nail down the runner, Evan Batone, trying to steal base.
That was amazing timing, just the way everything synced up. There was plenty of time by Ross just to get that done, and you see him sitting with the ball in his hand way before the batter even got there.
Great throw by Wright, leading Ross to his right side, right into that really awkward slide by Batone. Once again, looks like he started slipping once he knew that ball beat him, trying to get around the glove. Could not. Now, two balls thrown by right here. That last one didn't miss by much. So after scoring a run in both the first and the second innings, Akron has been held scoreless the past two. Now with two outs here in the top of the fifth, there's a strike thrown by Mitchell. Count goes even, 2-2.
Both of those runs, by the way, allowed by Rigo Ramos. Mitchell still perfect on the night.
And this one grounded sharply over to Seidel. Sam Seidel fields it cleanly at short, throws it over to Tackett's ends the inning. So Akron gets a base runner, caught stealing by Wright. And then Calvin Mitchell sends down the next one on a ground up. So Akron held scoreless the past three innings. We'll go to the bottom of the fifth. Bowling Green leading 3-2. You are listening to Falcon Baseball here on 88.1 WBGU.
A few years ago, Steve Faircow's lungs were failing.
I don't think I had more than a couple weeks to live.
That's when Steve received a lung transplant made possible by an organ donor. Now Steve can do things he never imagined, like climbing 94 floors to the top of a skyscraper.
I never knew that breathing could feel this good. It's an incredible gift.
What could you make possible as an organ, eye, and tissue donor? Leave behind the gift of life. Go to organdonor.gov, U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, Health Resources and Services Administration.
Matt always knew he wanted to be a doctor. That's why he makes the most of every day. To study before breakfast, to work hard, to do whatever was necessary to achieve his goal. He found an answer in the military. If you have a passion, a vision for your future in any field, todaysmilitary.com can be your path to a fulfilling career. You have a calling, we have an answer. Find your way at todaysmilitary.com.
Back here at Stellar Field in Bowling Green, Ohio, I'm Tyler Kavlitz, joined by Chaz McNeil. And Chaz, Calvin Mitchell's been pretty dominant out of the pen for the Falcons, just what they needed after a rocky start by Rigo Ramos.
That's right. Mitchell, he faced 11 different batters, and he's hasn't allowed a single run yet. He's absolutely flawless right now. And
he did allow that one run, but that was on the books of Rigo, who left him on base. So still nothing on his stat line just yet, like you said. As here is a bunt attempt by, that will be Nathan Archer, top of the order for the Falcons. He pulled it back in time, though. 1-0 the count. So Archer, Seidel, Newman, chance for the Falcons to do some more damage here. Chaz, top of the order.
And it's an underrated advantage to have Archer at the top. There's a reason he starts at the top of the batting order, and to get that in a fresh inning with no outs, nothing really to lose in that situation, is a really good sign for the Falcons, who have scored a lot towards the later half of the game, usually.
1-1 count. Archer just lost this one over into left field in front of Lafferty. So mark that as the third single of the game for Nathan Archer. Racking up the hits here today. I mean, you look at this lineup this year, and it's so much more spread out than it was last season. Last season was so top-heavy, but you look at the first four, I mean, Archer, Seidel, Newman, and Ross, and then after that, you got Banjoff and Krause, and then you have the luxury of putting Gavin Gannon all the way in the eight hole. Gannon, who's really developed a lot this season, getting his average and power up. And Garrett Wright in the nine hole. I mean, you look at the numbers he's putting up behind the plate. That's nothing to slouch about either, as Seidel swings and misses at the first pitch down 0-1. So, once again, Archer at first. They've had a close eye on him all weekend long, as Seidel swings and misses at another off-speed pitch here down 0-2-0. We have not seen Archer run, though. We've seen him attempt to on a few foul balls. But he stayed put other than that. Staying put once again as the pitch misses down low by Atkins. Atkins approaching 80 pitches now. So this could be his last inning of work, but like we've mentioned, he's gone very deep in the game's 111 pitches last time out. So who knows how much more he has left in the gas tank. The 1-2 pitch on the outside, 2-2, count evens. Bowling Green's done a good job, Chaz, the past few innings of working these counts a lot better than they did at the beginning of the game.
You're seeing a lot more full counts throughout the later half of these innings than they were allowing before. You're 1,000% right.
And this one popped up behind us. Count will stay at 2-2. We'll do it again.
I want to talk about for a second what you said about Atkins. Akron, pitching-wise, is not the best. They're very similar to Bowling Green in terms of they have very good starting pitchers, but once you get more deep into that bullpen, it thins out a lot, and they get a lot of their pitching production early on in matchups, and then they allow a lot more scoring. You look at the two games just in this series, the Falcons gave up, or the Zips gave up 5 runs in the 8th on Friday, and then 7 in the 8th on Saturday. So the later half of the games are where they kind of fall apart. So if you're seeing Atkins' arm deteriorate a little bit and give up, this could be a sort of turning point for BGSU, who are already up in the game.
Yeah, their depth in the bullpen not the greatest, kind of in the same situation as Bowling Green, still searching for those high leverage guys. Their best reliever this season came in yesterday and got blown up in that 8th inning. That was Kahook. So Seidel with 2 straight foul balls. He'll look at a ball on the outside here. Actually had 3 straight at one point during this at bat. So count evens at, or count goes full, actually at 3-2. Nathan Archer stands on first base. No outs here. Bottom of the 5th. Bowling Green leading Akron 3-2. Looking for the series sweep. Fouled off once again by Sam Seidel. Doing a great job of working this count. Keeping the at-bat alive at the same time. Rising Atkins' pitch count, which now stands at over 80.
Falcons doing a much better job at just staying alive, keeping the inning in their favor and just stretching it, taking up as much time as they can.
Archer's running on the pitch. This one driven right field, but hooked foul. So a few times now this game alone that Archer's tried to run on foul balls. We'll see if he decides to go again. Seidel roped that one. Needs to straighten it out a tad bit. 3-2 count. Once again, Archer stays put this time. This one misses inside, so Archer will get second either way. Sam Seidel draws the walk. He's on base for the second time today. And speaking of that, that streak of getting on base every time this season stays alive here today. Nearing 40 games in total if you stretch back to last season in a row that he's reached base. Just an on-base machine is Sam Seidel. So that'll bring DJ Newman up to the plate. Archer at second, Seidel at first. The pitch by Atkins swung on and missed by Newman, who has gone down both at-bats this season, or today, with strikeout swinging.
Newman not having the best outing right now, and then yesterday, he had a much better day. 5 at-bats, 3 hits, 2 runs. But
in this one over the head of Heyman at third base, Archer's going to round third. He's going to come home to score. RBI single for DJ Newman.
There's that hit. Right as you're talking about it, he gets that hit. And much better statistical now. What a massive, monumental play. I'm trying to think of another M word. For the Falcons, who they get one across. And you're 0 outs. You're at the top of your lineup, essentially. You still got some great batters left to go. This could be a little a momentum switch for the Falcons.
Chopped single over to third base. Bounced over the head of Heyman. Reached that outfield grass. Archer had a home plate in his mind all the way. Rounded third hard. Came home to score. Seidel only will advance to second. So it will be runners on first and second with no outs here. Bottom of the 5th. Do have a meeting at the mound. 2 arms up in that Akron bullpen, both right-handers. But Atkins will stay in the game. His pitch count now at 90. So if you look at him over the past 3 games now, Spencer Atkins has thrown nearly 300 pitches the past 3 outings. As now Tyler Ross up to bat. He'll sky this one left field. Going out is Sackett. Coming in is Lafferty. They're going to collide in left field. And that ball is not going to be caught. Down on the ground, it appears, is Sackett rolling around in pain. It must have been caught because we didn't advance. And I think it may have been caught. Looks like Tyler Ross is going back. But concern right now is in left field. Those Akron players colliding. Can't tell exactly who went down. Looks like it was Sackett. He was going out at shortstop. Lafferty was coming in. Lack of communication between the left fielder and the shortstop. They collided while both trying to make that catch. We'll take a quick break while this is being figured out and then get back to you with an update. You're listening to Bowling Green Baseball here on 88.1 WBGU.
You have the right to know. The right to know about culture. The right to know about the economy. The right to know about technology and to know about sports. You have the right to know about education and politics and the weather. You have the right to know what's happening abroad and in your backyard. But above all else, you have the right to know that this right is under attack, and we must work to protect it. Because in order to be free, we must be informed. Understand the threats. ProtectPressFreedom.org.
People join Walk MS to raise awareness and funds that change the world for everyone affected by multiple sclerosis. Walk MS brings communities together, creating teams with friends, loved ones, and coworkers to rally around those we care about and end MS forever. Together, we can change the world for people with MS. Register today at walkms.org.
Since the moment you were born, I've made 1,000 wishes. Wishes for your future in a world that's changing fast. Do play and laugh. Do win and lose. Do it all with confidence, kindness, and strength. And always do your best to remember that no matter what you do in this life, what matters to me is that you keep doing. Inspire kids to do at 4-H.org.
Dad, guess what?
What?
You are going to be a grandfather.
That's great. Not too long ago, moments like this with my daughter would have been a challenge. It was a long road for me to find myself again after Vietnam. It was my neighbor Jim, another Vietnam veteran, who finally convinced me that I could still connect with my family and find that fulfilling life I'd lost. And I went for help down at the VA. If I can take that first step after almost 50 years, I know other veterans can too. Visit maketheconnection.net to find out more.
When someone hears the words, you have cancer, it's one of the darkest moments in their life. Light the Night brings light to the darkness of cancer by uniting survivors, patients, and supporters in the cause to end cancer. We form a community of hope, raising funds in support of the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society. The discoveries made by LLS-supported research have led to breakthrough treatments for many cancers and other serious diseases. When we walk, cancer runs. Join the movement to end cancer today. Visit us at lightthenight.org.
Back here at Stellar Field, so Lafferty and Sackett are both going to exit the game after that collision in shallow left field. Scary situation. So,
defensive changes for
coming
the
into the game
in left field, number 30, Jack Poist.
Will be in left field, it will be
and
Jack Poist.
Number 7, Fisher Pyatt.
And Fisher Pyatt will enter the game at shortstop. So, Poist in left field for Lafferty, and Pyatt at short for Sackett. Shakes up the defense and the lineup a little bit for the Zips.
Poist, the senior from Hoover, Alabama.
And both those guys were in the starting lineup on Friday, so they have played the series. Pyatt went 0-for-2 on Friday, and Poist actually led off on Friday, went 0-for-4 at the plate. So that catch was made in the outfield. Wasn't able to see who made it, but on that collision by Lafferty and Sackett, one of them came up with the ball.
A tremendous catch.
And I believe we're going to say that it was Sackett who came up with that catch. So, one out now, bottom of the fifth. And stepping in will be Layden Banjoff. Nathan Archer has come around to score in this frame. Sam Seidel stands at second. DJ Newman at first. That first pitch by Atkins, a ball. Atkins pitch count over 90 now. Pickoff attempt to second. Seidel dives back in head first. So, Banjoff awaiting the pitch. He's 0 for 2 on the day. Has flown out to center and struck out swinging. This one catches the outside corner.
Banjoff looked that one all the way in.
1-1. 2-1 the count. And this one going to be driven to left field. Going back is Poist, moving to his right. He's going to make a catch as he slides down. Trying to advance to third will be Seidel. At the same time, Newman will go to second. So that will be a fly out to left field. That wind kept taking that into foul territory. Good job by Poist blocking out the sun and tracking it. Made the catch while sliding by the bullpen in that foul territory on the left side. But it will advance the runners one base. So Seidel at third now. Newman at second.
Right fielder,
Jack Krause will step up to bat. He has walked and grounded out to third base today.
Krause with two home runs in the sweep against Ball State last Sunday. So he's used to playing big on Sundays.
Check swing there. Did not go. It will be a ball. And Krause right now riding a 7-game hitting streak. He's going to pop this one up. That will go out of play. So count will go 1-1. Coming into the series, he had a 5-game hitting streak, 11 for 22 during that span, 9 RBI and 2 home runs. He has added on this series on Friday, 1 for 4 at the plate, drove in another run. And on Saturday, yesterday, 2 for 3, drove in 2 runs. So he's been on a tear as of late. Pitch to him outside, 2-1. Krause, the reigning MAC player of the week, entered this series second in the MAC in on-base percentage and sixth in batting average. I would say an improvement for 153 batting average and 255 on-base percentage last season in 31 games. As he looks at another ball up and away here. So 3-1 the count. 2 outs, bottom of the fifth, Bowling Green leading 4-2. Sam Seidel at third base, DJ Newman at second. Atkins, the 3-1 delivery. This one left up high, so a walk by Spencer Atkins loads the bases for the Falcons with 2 outs here in the bottom of the fifth.
Atkins now definitely showing signs of fatigue. You saw that. It looked like he put his whole body behind that pitch, and it was just high left.
Still those two right-handers up by the pen for Akron, but this will be his 100th pitch of the game coming up.
We have seen a grand slam already in this series coming yesterday.
That was Gavin Gannon. TJ Tackett up to bat. This ball gets away from Sprockett behind the plate. Sam Seidel is going to come home to score. Newman's going to round third, but he'll stay put. So that, you would have to think, most likely a wild pitch there. We'll see how it's scored. Either way, Sam Seidel comes home to score. Falcons now up by 3-5-2. They've scored twice in this frame. Still runner on second and third with 2 outs. And this one fouled off. So 1-1 will be the count. And that was ruled a wild pitch. So the 1-1 pitch here swung on and missed by Tackett's 1-2.
I just not right on that pitch from Tackett's.
You talk about that top of the order, though. Archer and Seidel have now scored 4 of the 5 runs for the Falcons. That's when this offense goes right, when those guys are getting on base. Tackett now dribbles this one behind the plate. Count stays 1-2. We'll do it again. Tackett has struck out looking and singled so far today. He actually advanced to second last inning on a wild pitch. Pitch to him, misses outside. Count goes even. So Atkins now over 100 pitches here today, which has become a common trend for his starts. This one caught the inside corner. T.J. Tackett goes down looking for the second time today, but Bowling Green crosses two more here in the bottom of the fifth. Their lead up to 5-2. You're listening to Bowling Green Baseball here on 88.1 WBGU.
Sweet strawberry icing.
You're in Goodwill, and just past that vintage denim jacket, you spot miniature donut earrings. You lean in. Ah, that's the scent of shopping success. Because at Goodwill, every item you buy funds local job training and more. So bring home those donut earrings, and bring home so much good to your community. Goodwill. Bring good home. Brought to you by Goodwill and the Ad Council.
Standing up for what's right. Helping out when things go wrong. Seeking the truth and speaking our minds. Not just making records, but breaking them. Leading the way behind the camera, beyond the runway, and on the silver screen. Not just making our mark, but making a difference. Now that's a job for a Girl Scout. Girl Scouts, preparing girls for a lifetime of leadership.
Back here in Bowling Green, Ohio, the Falcons have extended their lead to 5-2, scored two more in that bottom of the fifth, so all five runs coming in the third and fifth innings. On the mound for the Falcons, that is still Calvin Mitchell out there. Or actually, apologies, we are going to have a pitching change. I believe that is Isaiah Seidel.
Seidel with just five games, 4.2 innings pitched in this young-ish season.
He has not appeared in this series so far, as Fisher Pyatt checked into the game at shortstop for Nicky Sackett, went out of that game after that collision. He'll step into the box as there's a fastball in for a strike by Seidel. Seidel on the season, like you said, just his sixth appearance. He has a 15.43 ERA. In 4 2/3 innings pitched, does not have a decision. Four strikeouts, two walks, has allowed 8 earned runs and 5 extra base hits. But he has not walked a batter in the past two appearances, as after he threw in a strike on the outside corner, that one misses on the outside for a ball. He has been susceptible to the long ball, giving up 3 home runs in his past 3 outings. So 1-2 count on Fisher Pyatt. The pitch by Seidel fouled off. And Isaiah Seidel, the brother of Sam Seidel, if you were wondering hearing those last names. So a couple of brother duos in Bowling Green Athletics this season. You had the Spurgeon brothers in men's basketball, Jason and Greg. And Sam and Isaiah Seidel here for baseball. So the 1-2 pitch off speed. Froze him. Strike out looking by Isaiah Seidel to start his outing.
Pitching holding up much better. You had the shaky start at the beginning from Ramos, but besides that, and listen, I understand the commentator's curse, but Seidel with a very just well-designed pitching streak there with one out early in the sixth. This is a big moment for BG.
And Seidel gets Austin or Charlie Shebler to swing through that.
You can feel the heat coming off that ball whenever he throws.
He has velocity on those fastballs. That one fouled off. Has a very aggressive pitching motion, does Isaiah Seidel. As this one going to be grounded to second, Tyler Ross goes to an neat field, throws over to Tackett's. Easy two outs for Seidel to start the top of the sixth.
We saw a quick 1-2-3 by Mitchell in the past couple innings. Now with the chance, Isaiah Seidel with two out of three in a row.
And now stepping up to bat will be Braden Cavey, the first baseman. Cavey going to pop this one up. Right going back. Can it stay in play? This one does. And they're going to say that Garrett Wright made the catch at the fence. Akron's dugout does not agree. They're going to say that went off the netting. They're going to keep arguing that, but the call on the field is an out. Garrett Wright making the fantastic catch. So we will go to the bottom of the sixth. Bowling Green leading 5-2. You are listening to Bowling Green Falcons baseball here on 88.1 WBGU.
Most of us like to be out in the sun. That's why sunscreen and other safety measures are key to protecting your skin from aging and cancer. The FDA recommends using a sunscreen with an SPF of 15 or higher. Also, look for broad spectrum on the label. That means both harmful ultraviolet A and B rays are blocked. Remember, SPF plus broad spectrum equal healthy fun in the sun. Visit www.fda.gov/sunscreen for more information. A message from the U.S. Food and Drug Administration.
This is Artie Abrego, and you're listening to 88.1 FM WBGU Bowling Green, home of the Falcon Media Sports Network.
Uh-oh, Brad's buzzed.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, he's starting with the woots. And now a speech.
I just want to say that friendship is about heart. Heart and brain. Who's with me?
Good thing is, he knows when he's buzzed.
And my brain is saying, when it's time to go home, somebody call me a ride.
Love that guy.
Me too.
Know your buzzed warning signs? Call for a ride when it's time to go home. Buzz driving is drunk driving. A message from NHTSA and the Ad Council.
Back here in Bowling Green, Ohio. Isaiah Seidel coming in, locking down the zips, not allowing a run in the top of the sixth. We go to the bottom of the sixth for Bowling Green. It will be Gavin Gunnon, Garrett Wright, and then back to the top of the order with Nathan Archer here in the bottom frame of the sixth inning.
Number 19, Elijah Griffin.
And we do have a new pitcher in the game for Akron. It will be Elijah Griffith.
Gavin Gunnon, left field.
Griffith, this will be his seventh appearance on the season as his first pitch is low ball to Gunnon. Griffith, a freshman right-hander from New Albany, Ohio, standing at 6'2". Off-speed catches the outside corner for a strike, 1-1. His seventh appearance on the season, he has one start every other outing from the bullpen. 10.61 ERA, 9 1/3 innings pitched. He has struck out 10 and walked 9. This one drilled to left field. It will go foul, though.
This is also a great fact for Falcon fans. Griffith has allowed a run in every single game so far this season that he's played in.
And all but one of those have been an earned run. He has also had issues with walks recently, walked multiple batters in two straight outings, three of his past four appearances. Last game, he went four innings on Tuesday against Wright State as this one lined right up the middle by Gavin Ganon. That'll go to the outfield grass. Two strike hit by Ganon. Lead off single for the Falcons here in the bottom of the sixth.
Ganon threads the needle between Bowman and Pyatt in such a way to where it just perfect shot, just right down the middle. Neither of them could get to it in time, and that is a Falcon on first base.
And Griffith, I was saying before the hit, last outing on Tuesday against Wright State, he went four innings and 63 pitches. That was his longest outing. He also struck out five, the most strikeouts in an appearance this season for the right-hander. So Garrett Wright will step to the plate, the catcher. Looks at a pitch inside for a ball.
Catcher Garrett Wright.
And Atkins' day is over. We'll get to his line in just a second. As this one will hit, Garrett Wright runs inside on him. So that's a hit by pitch on Garrett Wright.
That's not the start to your day you want if you're Griffith.
No, and we'll have Sprockett going out to talk with him at the mound. But Spencer Atkins' day is done. He went five innings, threw 105 pitches, gave up seven hits and five runs, all of which were earned, walked three, and struck out six across 25 batters' face. So, all in all, chewed up a good amount of innings for the Zips. Just, he started off fast, but Chaz, this Falcons lineup got to him late, inflated those numbers by the time he left this game.
You could see that. You could tell with his arm starting to decay a little bit, the Falcons were just picking him apart.
And Nathan Archer showed bunt, pulled it back. Back to the top of the order now for the Falcons. 1-0 on Archer. Archer, Seidel, Newman, if we can get to all of them. Ganon at second, Garrett Wright at first. No outs here, bottom of the sixth. Archer swings, lines this into the left field. That's going to be past Poist. This is going to be extra bases. Ganon's going to come around to score. Garrett Wright's going to round third. He's going to come around to score also. That's going to be a two RBI double for Nathan Archer.
Archer having a massive day, to say the least. Three at-bats, two runs, three hits, and now two RBIs.
Have a day, Nathan Archer. Three singles and a double. And that scores Ganon and Wright. So Bowling Green's lead now stands at 7-2. The Falcons starting to pull away as we get through the middle innings of this one. Full mound meeting, all infield and pitching coach for Akron.
Archer, the only Falcon so far that's perfect above home plate, 4-4 at bats to hits.
And Archer coming into this with a lower batting average than he would like, 258, still very early in this season. But he has been a clutch player for Bowling Green. He's really developed power these past two seasons. 494 slugging percentage this season. That will go down as his sixth double of the season. Second on the team to Tyler Ross's seven. He also has four home runs. And you can chalk him up now for 26 runs driven in on the season. Far and away the most on this Bowling Green team. And to do that in the leadoff spot is pretty incredible. So it appears that we will have another pitching change here for Akron. So we will take a break, short break, get back to you to preview the new pitcher on the mound for Akron. Get back to the action. Bowling Green up 7-2 now. Bottom of the sixth. Still no one out. Runner on second. You're listening to Bowling Green Falcons Baseball here on 88.1 WBGU.
Tom has been a teacher for over 40 years. One day, I think one of the students had asked the question and he didn't remember the answer. And I also noticed that he was letting his class out earlier than they were supposed to let out. I was really starting to worry.
Levi and I talked about how it would change our lives, but he was there beside me. When something feels different, it could be Alzheimer's. Now is the time to talk. Visit alz.org/ourstories to learn more. A message from the Alzheimer's Association and the Ad Council.
Adopt US Kids presents What to Expect When You're Expecting a Teenager. Learning the lingo.
Jelly. Jelly adjective. Jelly is a shorter, better way to say jealous. As in, Chloe, I am like so jelly of your unicorn phone case.
You don't have to speak teen to be a perfect parent. Thousands of teens in foster care will love you just the same. Visit AdoptUSKids.org, brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, AdoptUS Kids, and the Ad Council.
Yet another pitching change here in Bowling Green. Tyler Cavillett's here with you, along with Chaz McNeil. And Chaz, the new pitcher for Akron, will be Josiah Ross, the freshman right-hander from Lewis Center, Ohio. Attended Olentangy Orange High School. His numbers a little inflated this season, 0-1 record, a 13.03 ERA, and 9.2 innings pitched. This will be his eighth appearance out of the pen. Three of his seven innings have been scoreless this season, but he really got battered on March 6th against Cincinnati, allowed seven earned runs in two-thirds of an inning against the Bearcats. Have really inflated his season numbers. He has eight strikeouts and nine walks on the season, has struggled with command at times, but he's also a guy that can get you, work some innings for you. He's pitched more than an inning in four of his seven appearances so far this season. He will be working from the stretch with Archer there at second. Sam Seidel at the plate. He'll look at the first one in the dirt for a ball. Archer still accountable for Griffith as this one driven to right field. Seeker doesn't have to move much. He'll catch that. Archer's going to attempt to tag to third. He will, sliding into third. So Seidel flies out, but he advances Nathan Archer over to third. Falcons threatening to add another run, already up 7-2 here in the bottom of the sixth, now one out.
The designated hitter, DJ Newman.
DJ Newman stepping up to the plate.
And this is a moment for Newman, who does have a hit on the day, but overall just not what you'd expect from him as a DH. This is where he could step up.
All four infielders on the inside edge of that infield dirt, looking to try to nail down Archer if they get a grounder to one of them on the infield. First pitch is a strike into Newman. He'll look at another one, catch the outside corner for the second strike, 0-2.
Like you said before, they have focused on making sure Archer stays where he's at. So they will be eyeing him over at third.
Josiah Ross comes set from the stretch. The delivery, the 0-2 pitch. This one grounded to the left side. Through the infield to the outfield grass. DJ Newman drives in another run for the Falcons. Their lead up to 8-2.
When they needed him, he appeared. DJ Newman just adding a RBI to his stat sheet. And honestly, if you're DJ Newman, that's exactly what you're in that lineup to do. You're in that lineup to just bring runs home. You're not at the top. You're not a leadoff guy. But because you're in that middle part, that third spot of the lineup, you're going to bring guys around, and that's exactly what he's doing.
Grounded pass, Heyman and Pyant at third and short. So Tyler Ross will step up to bat, looks at a first pitch strike. And we talked about Newman striking out those first two at bats swinging, but singles the past two, driven in two runs with those. So he's been productive the past two at bats, standing at first. Now 0-1 count on Ross. He'll look at this one in the dirt. Throw over to first. Newman dives back in head first, getting an aggressive secondary lead. Sprockett took note of that, tried to pick him off after the pitch. And that run was accounted to Griffith. So Ross still without an earned run. As this one fouled to the back, Tyler Ross going to shake his hand off. Reset, 1-2. Falcons have scored three in the bottom of the sixth. The 1-2 pitch off speed, locked him up. Tyler Ross goes down looking. So now two outs for Akron. Locked him up, nothing Ross could do there. Good off speed pitch by Ross. And he had worked him with a few fastballs before that, caught him by surprise with it. By the time Ross thought about swinging the bat, it was too late. So Banjoff will step in. He'll look at a first pitch strike. If you want to give Ross credit for something right now, coming in, he's really hitting the zone early in these counts, getting ahead of these Falcons. Still some action in that Akron bullpen. He leaves this fastball up high, 1-1. Ross has held batters to just a .263 batting average this season. This pitch, little up and in to Banjoff.
Pitching change kind of seeming like it's what Akron needed right in that moment. You have BGSU scoring all these runs, going up 8-2, and stopping the bleeding a little bit as Ross, but overall, let's see if he can finish out this inning.
This in their first strike evens the count at 2-2. Banjoff 0-for-3 on the day. He has flown out to center and left. Also struck out swinging. Looking for his first hit of the day. As running now is Newman. This one going to be fouled off to the back, so Newman will have to go back to first. Newman running there with two outs. Possible hit and run for the Falcons. Banjoff 2-for-3 on Friday, 1-for-5 yesterday. Looking for his first hit today. Looks at this one inside. Count runs full. 3-2, two outs. So Newman will be running on this pitch.
Ross looking to close everything out with a full count.
Newman goes. The pitch is just inside. So Layden Banjoff gets on base for the first time today. Draws a walk. It'll be first and second with two outs for the Falcons. That will bring up Jack Krause. Krause has walked twice, still without a hit today. He's also grounded out to third base. Krause drove in two runs yesterday. Looking for that big hit here, bottom of the sixth, really blow this one open.
It's been a long sixth inning in the cold. That's got to add some fatigue to Akron's side, who have been standing out there for the better part of...
Dealing with all that wind. Just making it feel ever so colder. The pitch to Krause. Big swing and a miss on that first pitch. He'll step out of the box and reset for just a second. Two outs here, bottom of the sixth. Bowling Green leading 8-2. Runners on first and second for the Falcons. Jack Krause down 0-1. He'll look at a ball to even the count. Newman the runner on second. Banjoff the runner on first. Bowling Green looking to extend their mark in the history book today in multiple different ways. Looks at another one outside. 2-1 the count. Hitters count for Jack Krause. Now the pitch outside once again. So 3-1 count on Bowling Green's right fielder. We'll see if he has the green light or if he's looking for something perfect. Pitch from Ross. Up and away. So two straight walks there by Josiah Ross. Falcons have loaded the bases with two outs here in the bottom of the sixth. TJ Tackett's coming up to bat. And this inning started with Gavin Gannon, the eight-hole hitter. We're already down to Tackett's seventh in the batting order. So if Tackett gets on, we will have batted around. And that's a discussion in itself with baseball, is batting around, getting through everyone once, or getting back to the leadoff hitter. In my mind, it's getting back to the leadoff hitter.
I mean, both give you different strategies. If you make it back to the leadoff, obviously you start the next inning on that leadoff. But going towards the middle of your lineup means you get a much stronger middle portion of your batters in the next inning. So it's strategy. It depends on whoever coach is.
So Tackett's 1-for-3 on the day. He's singled, has also struck out looking twice. Bases loaded for him here. Newman on third, Banjoff on second, Krause on first. Looks at the first pitch by Ross outside for a ball. Really trying to blow this one open with a big hit here. Ross comes set from the stretch. Pitch is swung up the middle. It's going to be fielded by Pyatt at short. He'll throw over to KB. So Falcons threaten once again with bases loaded. Cannot deliver at the end of the inning. However, they do add three runs onto the board. Their lead now up to 8-2. We will go to the top of the seventh. You're listening to Bowling Green Falcons Baseball here on 88.1 WBGU.
All the talks we've had over the years, including what you've told me about not using alcohol and other drugs, they stick with me. And believe it or not, they really do make a difference, especially at times that matter most.
Hey, want a drink?
No thanks, I'm good. So thank you, Dad, for talking and preparing me for what's ahead.
Thank you for talking.
For more information about talking with your kids about underage use of alcohol and other drugs, visit underagedrinking.samhsa.gov.
If you suffer from COPD symptoms like shortness of breath and fatigue, where do you turn? There are medications and oxygen, but do you know about pulmonary rehab? 3 out of 5 COPD patients have never heard of it. Pulmonary rehab is an exercise, education, and support program that gives you tools to manage your condition, and Medicare typically pays for it. So whether it's grocery shopping on your own or just walking across the room, pulmonary rehab can help you. Visit livebetter.org to find out about your options for pulmonary rehab today.
Back here at Stellar Field in Bowling Green, Ohio. Isaiah Seidel still on the mound for the Falcons. And Chaz, they've really started to blow this one open, up by 6 runs now going into the top of the seventh are the Falcons.
That's right, Tyler. The Falcons, at the very beginning, it looked like this game was in favor of Akron. It was under their control. They go up 2 runs early. They completely just take over the momentum of the game, causing the Falcons to swing, create easy hits, create fieldable plays. But now the Falcons are just going through their lineups, going through Akron pitchers, and Akron kind of feels like they're on their heels right now.
So we do have a couple substitutions. Jack Krause will move over to left field for Gavin Gannon. And we will have a substitution in right field also. As it will be Caden Parker in right field for the Falcons. 1-1 count here on Sam Seeker. This one misses outside by Seidel. 2-1. So Caden Parker in right field. Jack Krause moves from right to left for the Falcons. The 2-1 delivery by Seidel. That one in there evens the count at 2 apiece. Seidel worked a clean bottom of the sixth, looking to, or top of the sixth, looking to do same here, top of the seventh. This one popped up to the left side. That's going to go out of play. So we'll replay 2-2.
The wind took that one. That one was actually, if there was no wind, and that's a big if, but the wind just
that's a hard ask in Bowling Green, Ohio.
That is a blowing green, but that just the wind just absolutely swept that one up.
It's been doing a lot of that this series, blowing out basically straight to left field and in. Temperature risen a little bit again, up to 43 degrees. Winds up to 14 miles per hour here in Northwest Ohio. As we're going to have a bat change. Looks like bat may have gone dead. So Sam Seeker will switch up bats. 2-2 count on the lefty. Isaiah Seidel on the mound for the Falcons. Seidel comes set, working from the stretch. Seidel's 2-2 delivery. This one fouled off the left side once again. Interesting, Seidel, you know, one of those guys that doesn't really go from the windup. He'll go from the stretch with a runner on or not. Some pitchers prefer that. Some prefer to have that variance, go from the windup when they can.
And you're right about that aggressive wind, that aggressive pitching motion.
As he gets Sam Seeker to swing an off-speed pitch. Mark that as the second strikeout for Seidel in an inning and a third pitched. Four up, four down for Isaiah Seidel. Akron's catcher Michael Sprockett coming up to bat. He singled in the second and advanced on a throwing error and a pickoff attempt. As he chops this one a right side, fielded by Tackett's, but in foul territory. He has also flown out to center field. And you were talking about that, Chaz, that Akron really had full control early on. They kind of did that in the middle innings of yesterday's game, and Bowling Green stormed back and took that lead. They did that earlier in this one. They were the ones that controlled the middle innings, now holding that six-run advantage. As this one found back by Sprockett.
And that was all sparked yesterday by Gavin Ganon on that grand slam. And if Akron can find some of that magic, well, first they have to get a couple zips on base. But once that happens, you get some of that magic. It's all about just building that momentum, waiting for the right moment, and then you can score a couple runs in a row. You can get hot.
So the 0-2 delivery by Seidel misses outside. Count goes to 1-2. Yeah, Seidel, that violent motion coming towards the plate kind of goes low to the ground. His 1-2 delivery and off speed that swung out to left field pretty deep. That's Krause going after it. It'll go to the wall. And Sprockett will stride into second base with a stand-up double. Michael Sprockett gets an extra base hit with one out for Akron. They have a runner in scoring position looking to try to get back into this game.
That just a deep back shot to left field. And with the wind, who knows? It might have been carried even further. But it was just a massive shot by Sprockett.
Anything that's hit to left field right now, that wind just trails it towards the foul fair line. That one reaching the wall. Krause couldn't get to it in time. So, Henry Heyman, the 9-hole hitter, will be up to bat. Looks at a first pitch strike by Seidel. After him, we'll go back up to the top of the order with Evan Batone. Sprockett on base for the second time in three at-bats. That's second. Seidel's pitch home. In there for a strike with a fastball. 0-2 count on Heyman. Seidel already with two strikeouts.
We saw a similar position like this with Sprockett just one at bat ago.
Seidel takes a look back. The second now goes home. This one grounded to his brother Sam Seidel at short. He'll throw over to TJ Tackett's at first. 6-3 ground out. And Michael Sprockett will stay at second. So two outs. Sprockett still at second base. Back to the top of the order with Evan Batone.
Evan Batone, center field.
Seidel still working from that stretch. Delivers home first pitch up high with a fastball. Batone has walked. He has also singled and grounded out to right. The catcher grounded out in the second inning. Was caught stealing in the top of the fifth after singling to get on. This one misses inside by side also. Behind the leadoff hitter, 2-0.
Seidel choosing his pitch.
Batone looking to get something going for Akron. They haven't had much offensive activity since that second inning, as this one misses high and away, 3-0 the count now. Batone came into this series on an 0-for-10 stretch over his past three games. As there's a strike into him there, 3-1 the count. On Friday, he was able to break that, get two hits and four at-bats. And yesterday, 3-for-5, so he's been heating up as of late. Looking for his third straight multi-hit game after being hitless for three straight. And this one's going to be high and away, so he will instead draw the second walk of the game for him. He'll go to first. Runners on first and second, two out here top of the seventh for Akron.
Left fielder, Jack Poist.
So Jack Poist will come up to bat now.
Bowman taking a hefty lead on first.
Poist drives this center field. That's going to drop in front of Archer. Every runner will advance one base. Sprocket held up there at third will not advance. Archer did a good job of getting that ball in time.
Akron now, like we said just a second ago, now they've got the bases loaded. You're bringing up a guy who is Bowman. Or, yeah, they brought Bowman back.
Yeah, and
pinch.
Kyle Hallock going to go to the mound for a meeting. We'll see what he decides to do here.
But Bowman with a 2.288 batting average. Not particularly one of the guys you want to go to, but one of the better batting averages on the team. And with the bases loaded, creates a great opportunity for Akron, who are down six.
Well, and we talked about it as a whole. This Akron team has really struggled on offense this season. We were going through the numbers pregame, seventh worst batting average in the country coming into this one. And 10th worst slugging percentage in the nation. So Isaiah Seidel will stay out there on the mound. Just a mound visit there to go over a few things.
The second baseman, Max Bowman.
Two outs here, top of the seventh. Akron has the bases loaded for Max Bowman, the second baseman. He is 0-for-2 on the day, has grounded out to short. Popped out to first and walked, has a stolen base after that walk. He looks at a strike there from Seidel.
That one just hot and right down the middle by Seidel.
Seidel's 0-1 delivery. This one hit up the middle. That'll find the outfield grass in front of Archer. One comes around to score. Akron's going to score two. They'll have runners on first and third with two outs. Akron first run since the second inning. That was Sprocket came around to score on third, and Batone came from second around to score. Poist, who was on first, advances to third.
And that's the spark that you want to see from Akron. Bats are heating up a little bit. You just brought it up that their batting average, their slugging percentage is just not that great. They're bottom of the NCAA, and to be able to do that, to shrink the lead by to four runs, it creates an opportunity with two on base.
And we will have a pitching change. I believe that's Connor Penrod coming from the pen. So we'll take a quick break, go over the new pitcher for Bowling Green. and get back to it. Akron still threatening with two outs. They've put two on the board, but Bowling Green still leads 8-4 in the top of the seventh. You're listening to Bowling Green Falcons Baseball here on 88.1 WBGU. Don't go anywhere.
Hi, it's Olivia Munn with my shelter pets, Frankie and Chance. Say hi, guys. When I adopted them, I discovered that they both have incredible personalities. Chance's sole purpose in life is to love and to be loved. Frankie is a little bit of a scoundrel and always entertaining. They're a little bit of a lot of things, but they're all pure love. Adopt pure love at theshelterpetproject.org. Brought to you by the Ad Council, the Humane Society of the United States, and Maddie's Fund.
Back here in Bowling Green, Ohio, new pitcher for the Falcons is Connor Penrod, the junior right-hander out of Wauseon, Ohio, his third season with the Falcons. He was the best reliever out of the bullpen for Bowling Green last season. He led the Falcons with 4 wins, 18 appearances, and a 3 ERA. That was the best ERA of any Bowling Green pitcher that pitched at least 10 innings. This season been a little different story, though, Chaz. He's 1-1 on the season. This will be his 7th appearance out of the pen, his first since Sunday, last Sunday, against Ball State. He's pitched 6 1/3 innings, an 11.37 ERA for the right-hander. He has 7 strikeouts, but he's struggled with walks, allowing 10, giving up 4 extra base hits and an opponent batting average of .387. He is primarily a two-pitch pitcher. Features a fastball that'll be high 80s, and he also has a curveball that'll be low to mid 70s.
And at this point, bringing in Penrod is just trying to alleviate some of the pitching issues. The Falcons found their guy for a good chunk of the game in Mitchell, but with Seidel, he had a good start, kind of fell off a little bit towards the end, and now you bring in Penrod, like you said, two-pitch guy. Not doing a whole lot. He creates a lot of walks, but it's not. It's not one of those things. They have to pitch a lot tighter. They have to create less opportunities for Akron, who have 2 men on base right now. So this feels like.
And Fisher Pyatt started with a walk. He's gonna drive this one in the right field. That'll score another run. Coming around to score for Akron is Jack Poist. So. Like we mentioned, those control issues for Penrod this season starts with a ball, that one lined in the shallow right field. Another run comes across for Akron. They're making a late push. 3 runs here in the top of the seventh. Bowling Green's lead has dwindled down to 3 runs, 8-5.
Late push is the right thing to call it. This was nobody on base, two outs, just a few minutes ago. And now Akron have completely turned this inning on its head and managed to score 3 runs.
Charlie Shebler, the DH up. Ball high and away there by Penrod. Runners on first and second with 2 outs. All this damage done with 2 outs for Akron. It's been a 2-out rally for the Zips. Max Bowman stands on second. Fisher Pyatt on first. Penrod's pitch to Shebler. Big swing and miss by Shebler. And I believe that may have been a foul tip. As the umpire is going to meet Penrod midway between home plate and the mound, just the switch balls. So Connor Penrod, 1-1 count on Charlie Shebler. Shebler 0-3 on the day. He's flown out to right field, grounded out to first, and grounded out to second. Shebler coming to this with a .333 batting average on the season. Another big cut and a miss by the designated hitter. The lefty swings through that pinch by Penrod. 1-2 count.
Shebler trying to cash in on the 2 men on base. The big swing of momentum. A massive hit here. A big hit would probably end up tying this game.
Connor Penrod looking to escape without allowing any more damage. This one going to be tipped foul. So we'll redo 1-2. Penrod was so good for these Falcons last year. He was their main high-leverage reliever. Bowling Green still searching for those high-leverage relievers. You have a few guys showing up like Jacob Turner, but have not really established anyone as that go-to guy out of the bullpen. Penrod, the 1-2 pitch, fouled off once again, this time to the left side. So we'll do 1-2 once again. Penrod working from the stretch against Schebler. Schebler had a four-game hitting streak come to an end yesterday. Been hitless now, including today's past two. The 1-2 delivery from Penrod. This hit up the middle. Sam Seidel going to come up with it. He'll go to second, moving to his left. Good play there by Seidel to end the inning as he just steps on second base for the out. So Akron does score three in the top of the seventh. Bowling Green still holds an 8-5 advantage going into the seventh inning stretch and bottom of the seventh. So we'll take a quick break and be back with you for more Bowling Green baseball here on 88.1 WBGU.
Some knowledge belongs to us and us alone. The way our girlfriends walk, talk, touch their hair. Details that only a sister can know about her girls. But what about our other girls? The ones we carry with us every day. Our bond with our sister girls gives life. But knowing your breasts can save it. Go to knowyourgirls.org for the facts you need on breast health. Brought to you by Susan G. Komen and the Ad Council.
Melissa from Michigan. I work an extra part-time job serving lunch at my child's school, but I still can't afford to put food on our table.
Daniel from California. Choosing whether to pay the rent or pay to fix the car to get to work doesn't leave us with much at all. Now we can't even pay for meals.
Hunger is a story we can end. End it at feedingamerica.org. Brought to you by Feeding America and the Ad Council.
Falcons up to bat once again in the bottom of the seventh. Akron scored three in the top of the seventh.
Leading off the bottom of the seventh for the Falcons, the right fielder, Caden Parker.
So Caden Parker in the bat for Gavin Gannon, substituted in the field last half inning. He will take Gannon's spot in the lineup. Fouls this one off. Ross still in there for Akron. This one a ball away, 1-1 the count. Caden Parker, righty on righty matchup. This one up and in. Ball 2-1 the count on Parker. And Bowling Green looking to respond. Chaz after Akron got back into this top half of the inning as Parker looks at another ball, 3-1 the count.
And when you score three runs like that, you don't really expect.
This one drilled into right field. That's going to be inside, fair ball. Parker's going to round first. He'll go to second. Slide into second with a double. That ball skips away from Bowman. It'll be fielded, though, by Pyatt. Caden Parker with a leadoff double for the Falcons.
Just finishing that point before, though, if you're the Falcons and you put up three runs, that's considered a very good inning. And then Akron just come back. They immediately respond. Your pitching situation gets exposed a little bit. And now you're sitting at the exact same lead you had before, but it feels a little bit different. It feels like Akron's coming back a little bit. They're swinging a little bit harder at everything you throw.
So now Garrett Wright, the catcher, up to bat, looks at a First pitch, strike. Ross looking to keep this inning under control now after that leadoff double by Parker. This one in the dirt. 1-1. Did not go. Check swing there by Garrett Wright. And that's the second double of the season for Caden Parker, the junior outfielder out of Westland, Oregon. Another ball in the dirt here. 2-1 the count. Bowling Green looking to have more damage here in the bottom of the seventh, trying to start putting this one away. Going to catch the outside corner here for a strike. Count evens at 2-2. Garrett Wright today is 0-4-2. He has flown out to right, grounded out to short, and has been hit by a pitch. Came around to score his last time up to bat. This one lofted into center field. That's going to be in front of Batone. Coming around third and scoring is Caden Parker. RBI single by Garrett Wright.
That was a nice, strong hit. Right to the center of the field in a perfect spot. All green and enough time to bring a Falcon.
And it appears that we're going to have another pitching change for Akron. So we'll take another quick break, get back to preview the new man on the mound for the Zips. Bowling Green scores another one here. Bottom of the seventh, still no one out. Their lead stands at 9-5. You're listening to Bowling Green Falcons Baseball here on 88.1 WBGU.
Did you know that people born from 1945 to 1965 have the highest rates of hepatitis C, but most don't know they're infected? People can live for decades without symptoms, but over time, hepatitis C can cause serious health problems, including liver damage and even liver cancer. If you were born from 1945 to 1965, the CDC recommends that you get a blood test for hepatitis C. So talk to your doctor about getting tested. It could save your life. A message from the CDC.
All over America, people are taking the national radon test. Have you? Answer true or false. Radon is a radioactive gas. True.
I didn't know that, no.
True or false. The Office of the Surgeon General recommends that all homes be tested for radon. True, your home should be tested. True or false, radon is the second leading cause of lung cancer. True.
I'm gonna dial the number and call.
1-800-SOS-RADON.
Keep your family safe from radon. Call now.
1-800-SOS-RADON.
The new pitcher for the Zips is Sean Perkins, the junior right-hander, standing at 6'4" out of Cambridge, Ohio. On the season, this will be his eighth appearance all out of the bullpen. 1-1 is his record. He holds a 2.87 ERA. That's the best on this Zips team. He has pitched 15 and two-thirds innings, 7 strikeouts, 8 walks. He has allowed 4 extra base hits, and he leads the Zips with a 2.22 batting average against and just a 1.28 whip. And he has had some memorable moments so far this season, Chaz.
Well, the biggest moment of the season for this Akron team is one of their five wins came against Duke, number 10 in the country at the time, and Perkins was actually named MAC Pitcher of the Week because of that win. In the last season, in 8 games.
And not only the win of the team, he was credited with that win.
Yeah, he was credited
the
with that
Blue
win.
Devils.
Just an unreal performance. Just in one of those games where you look at the score and you see Akron, who are bottom of nearly every stat in the NCAA, and your jaw kind of drops a little bit. A little bit of a statement win.
So top of the order now for Nathan Archer. Fouls this one off. He has Garrett Wright on first base. And, Chaz, he hasn't allowed an earned run in 2 straight outings. 3 of his past 4 appearances. Has had a little issues with control. Walked 7 batters in the past 5 2/3 innings pitched. As this one poked into left field by Nathan Archer. That'll be a single. Move Garrett Wright to second. Archer goes to first. First and second for the Falcons. Nobody out here in the bottom of the seventh.
That puts Archer at 5 for 5 in at-bats. An absolutely unreal stat. And off of that, he's got 3 runs, 2 RBIs, and a double.
Have a day, Nathan Archer. Hard to be much more productive than that. Sam Seidel up to the plate. Seidel looks at a fastball outside here at 4-ball. Seidel has popped out to third base. He has singled, walked, and flown out to right field his last time up to bat. Looks at a fastball that catches the outside corner here by Perkins. 1-1 the count. Sean Perkins last time on the mound Tuesday against Wright State. Went an inning. Did not allow a run. Gave up a hit. Hit a batter. 11 pitches for the reliever. Throws over here to second with Wright. Just letting him know he has his attention. Pretty straight up defense for Akron. Sam Seidel hits this one off to the right, but foul. Sat back on that off speed, but was still a little bit ahead of it. Trying to unload on it, got all top of the ball. So 1-2 the count on the shortstop. This one in there for a ball. 2-2.
Seidel with a hit and 2 runs already today.
Yeah, and we were talking about that earlier. Now the top 2 guys in the order scored 5 of the 9 runs for Bowling Green, doing what they are supposed to do. This one off speed on the outside. Full count, 3-2. Still nobody out here, bottom of the seventh. Bowling Green looking to really try to blow this one open. Seidel gonna rip this one right field. Going back is Seeker. He's on the warning track, makes the catch. Both runners will try to advance. Right into third, Nathan Archer into second. If we did not have wind blowing and into left field, that may have had a shot. Seeker caught it on the warning track just in front of that right field wall.
If you're head coach Kyle Halleck, you're happy with that. That's a fine possession. You have no outs. And you do get one out of that, but still, you advance runners to third and second. You're threatening now, and you're bringing in DJ Newman, who already has an RBI on the night. He's actually got 2.
Talk about heating up throughout this game. Struck out his first 2 at-bats, has responded with back-to-back singles. Like you said, drove in a run on each of those. Checks his swing here. This one can go foul to the right. The Akron infield once again on that inside edge of that infield dirt, looking to prevent a run if they can. The outfield's still fairly deep. They're going to shade Newman a tad bit to the right. Pitch to Newman. This one lined on a rope right but foul. So down 0-2 quick. One out here, bottom of the seventh. Garrett Wright on third. Nathan Archer on second base. DJ Newman, the designated hitter at the plate, the 0-2 pitch. Newman checked his swing, did not go on the off-speed pitch that was outside.
It's clear Newman wants to break something big here. This would be a huge opportunity for the Falcons.
Sean Perkins comes set, his 1-2 delivery to Newman. This one hit up the middle, almost hits Perkins through the outfield grass. Wright's going to score. Archer's going to round third and score. 4 RBIs on the day for DJ Newman.
And that's why they made him the designated hitter. That's what he does best. 4 RBIs, 4 at-bats.
DJ Newman with all 4 RBI in the past. 3 at-bats, 3 straight singles for the two-way star. And Bowling Green has added on 3 runs in 2 straight innings. Still just 1 out here, bottom of the seventh. Newman on first. Now Tyler Ross will come up to bat. Went down looking his last time at the plate. Looks at a ball here, first pitch. And that single up the middle almost hit Perkins, had to move out of the way. Bowman and Pyant were not able to get to it. Leaked out to that outfield grass. So now this one's going to be chopped, but I think it hit Ross in the batter's box. It'll be a foul ball. So 1-1 the count.
Perkins barely able to get out of the way of that Newman hit. I'm still thinking about it. The way he just had to move his body right out of the side.
And you want to talk about, as here's a pickoff attempt at first, just this offense is not slowing down. If you were wondering if the offensive output was because of the warm weather in Tennessee, this right here might prove otherwise. Double-digit runs in three straight games to the Falcons. They scored 10 on Friday, 11 yesterday, up to 11 here today against the Zips. This one fouled off to the back, so 1-2. As we're going to have a stoppage here, Tyler Ross walking back towards the dugout. Believe they're looking at the bat. So he'll keep the same bat. Go back to the box. Down in the count, 1-2, one out here. The pitch by Perkins comes inside and it hit him.
Looks like it hit him on the hand.
Tyler Ross draws the hit by pitch. So he'll move to first. DJ Newman will move to the second, just like that. Falcons with another runner in scoring position. And we will have a runner for Tyler Ross. That will be David Silva.
Running for Ross on first base, number 4, David Silva.
Silva will run for Ross at first. Newman at second. Leighton Banjoff steps into the box. 0 for 3 in the day. Has flown out to center and left. Struck out swinging and has drawn a walk. This pitch inside for a ball.
Yeah, Banjoff not having the game you'd want for him, but we saw with Newman. He started cold, heated up towards the end of the game. This is a spot for Banjoff with the whole pitching situation going on where Akron is clearly showing fatigue, where there's definitely a big opportunity here for Banjoff.
And we're going to have another meeting on the mound here between the Akron infield. And that meeting has finished up. Sean Perkins still going to stay in the game. Just discussing a few things. And Bowling Green, like we mentioned, double-digit runs for the third straight game. When you look at their season as a whole, when they score 10 or more runs, they are 7-1 this season. Their only loss when they score at least 10 runs was on February 24th. They lost 13-14 against Memphis. This one popped up to the right side. Going after it is Cavey. He cannot corral it. So, Leighton Banjoff will get another shot. 1-1 the count.
Falcons still with one out. It's still very early on in this bottom of the seventh. There's a whole lot more of a ball game left to play.
As here's the pitch by Perkins. This one shot straight up into the air. Shallow center field. Going out for it was both Bowman and Pyatt. Bowman can't catch it. As we're going to have runners advance, so everyone advances a base. Bowman and Pyant were both going out towards it. Patone was coming in. Bowman caught it, couldn't catch it. So DJ Newman will advance to third. David Silva running for Tyler Ross will advance to second. And Leighton Banjoff will go to first.
just a tough moment for Bowman, who had it right in his glove. It seemed, I don't know about you, Tyler, but it looked like there was another weird little miscommunication where there were two infielders right there and just unable to either make any decision.
Yeah, Jack Krause up to bat. So we are going to have that scored as an error. So that'll be E4 as a strike and a ball from Perkins. 1-1 the count. And the pitch here is fouled off to the left side. So we are going to have, if we reach it, next up to bat will be Brady Birchmeyer. He will be pinch hitting for TJ Tackett's. One and two pitches in the dirt. 2-2.
Krause with just one at bat here today. No recorded stats.
2-2 the count. And this one outside, full count.
Bases loaded for the Falcons. Krause, who's had a big couple of games in recent memory.
Full count pitch, this one low and away, and that will be a walk for Jack Krause.
It's just like what you said, Tyler. Those walk issues are kind of rearing their head at the wrong time for Akron.
So Newman will come in to score off of the walk. David Silva to third. Layden Banjoff to second. And Brady Birchmeyer coming up to bat.
Pinch hitting for Tackett's. A freshman from New Lothrop, Michigan. Number 43, Brady Birchmeyer.
Brady Birchmeyer into bat for Bowling Green.
Birchmeyer just a freshman.
This one grounded to short, fielded by Pyatt. He actually misfields it. The throw to first is offline, gets past Cavey. And Bowling Green's going to round the bases. A few more will score. As actually now we're going to have Jack Krause call a pickle. He'll go back to third, tagged out. So we will have two more come around to score. Jack Krause got stuck in between third and home there. He will be tagged out. So coming around to score will be David Silva. He came from third. Banjoff comes around from second to score, and Krause is out at third.
Losing Krause was not ideal, obviously, with two on threatening bases, but still, great position for the Falcons. Just these mistakes by the Zips are costing them time and time again.
And the Falcons have now batted around. Caden Parker, who started off this inning with a double, is back in the batter's box. Oh, look at a strike here. So two strikes on him. Oh, two the count. Brady Birchmeyer at second. This one lined on the ground, left side. Pyatt can't get to it. Birchmeyer's going to round third. Birchmeyer coming home. The throw from Poyce, not in time, going to be cut off. Brady Birchmeyer will score. Falcons now with a seven spot in the bottom of the seventh. Their lead has ballooned to 15-5. And that is actually going to be the game. So the Falcons will run rule the Zips here. The run rule is in play on Sundays. So the seven spot in the bottom of the seventh means the game is over. 15-5, Bowling Green with the victory. We'll take a second and then get back to you guys. We'll talk about what this victory means in terms of history for this program and recap all of the action. So Bowling Green winners here on Sunday. They sweep the Akron Zips in their opening homestand 15-5 here today. You're listening to Bowling Green Baseball on 88.1 WBGU.
Women Heart is in a race to save lives. Heart disease is the number one killer of women. It's 80% preventable if you know the facts. Millions of women are living with or at risk of heart disease. Get educated. See your doctor. Know the facts. To win this race, we all have to do it together. Our hearts beat as one. To learn more, visit womenheart.org.
The average time a resume spends on an HR manager's desk is 7 seconds, and most of them are tossed aside. Now imagine if one of those resumes belonged to Yasmin, who was
living in a shelter, juggling 3 jobs. I had to be resilient. That's something that you can't teach.
We rely so much on a resume, yet it could never tell the full story of someone who
had to be independent and take initiative, and that's how I handle every project I get.
Discover new ways to develop great talent at gradsoflife.org. Brought to you by Grads of Life and the Ad Council.
Welcome back to The Dog Show. Up next, we have Satchmo. Satchmo is a member of the Shelter Pet Group.
That's right, a group known especially for their couch-snuggling, ball-chasing, face-licking, and, of course, companionship. Now, let's see him in action.
Look how he makes eye contact with his person.
That's actually known as the treat stare.
How intuitive, and now he appears to be excitedly turning in circles.
Ah, the happy dance so common with this group.
But really, the best way to know an amazing shelter pet like Satchmo is to meet one.
Visit theshelterpetproject.org today. Adopt.
Brought to you by Maddie's Fund, the Humane Society of the United States, and the Ad Council.
The possibility of lung cancer can be pretty scary, especially if you're one of approximately 8 million current or former smokers at high risk. That's why SaveByTheScan.org wants you to know that now there's a breakthrough low-dose CT scan that can detect lung cancer early, and it only takes 60 seconds. You stop smoking, now start screening. For an easy quiz to see if you're eligible, visit SaveByTheScan.org. It could save your life. SaveByTheScan.org is brought to you by the American Lung Association's Lung Force Initiative and the Ad Council.
What a start to this season by these Bowling Green Falcons. This baseball program had only seen a team start 7-0 in conference play one time before the season. That was 1995. Then yesterday, the Falcons beat the Zips 11-6. They moved to 8-0 in MAC play for the first time in program history. Now they defeat the Zips 15-5 here on Sunday afternoon, moving to 9-0 for the first time in MAC play in program history. More and more history being etched into the history books for this Bowling Green program.
That's right, Tyler. Get your brooms out. And if they're already out, that's fine. They might be broken because the Bowling Green State University Falcons have swept for the third straight time in a row in MAC play for the first time since 2008, which came against Akron. Just like you were saying. So a massive, awesome thing for BGSU to get this opportunity. You're 9-0 in MAC play, top of the MAC when you were picked 8th. You have more wins in the MAC right now than places you were voted to be in, which is unreal.
Yeah, so if you look at that, what you were referencing is that this program has not had 3 straight MAC sweeps at any point in the season since 2008. They did it against Ohio, Buffalo, and Akron in 2008, and they do it here today. They complete and finish it off against Akron. They had previously swept Miami of Ohio and Ball State. There is a 14-4 loss against Dayton and a postponement against Youngstown State in there. But put that aside, just look at MAC play. Incredible for Bowling Green. And looking around the MAC, we have 2 games going on right now. Kent State trailing St. Joseph's out of conference play 4-0. And we had the final here. And that is all that we have live games right now around the MAC. But just dominating for Bowling Green once you got to those middle innings today. They just didn't let off the pedal. Who sticks out to you in terms of key performances, Chaz?
Well, It depends on what inning we're talking about, because every single inning it felt like there was another big name that just stood out in a moment when it was needed. I would go Nathan Archer. He was perfect above home plate. He was 5 of 5. Brought in a ton of runs for his squad, and you just can't beat that. You can't beat that level of consistency. You talk to Kyle Hallock, and he calls him a pro player on this team. He calls him a pro athlete on this college team, and you can't beat that. An unreal stat line for him, unreal night, unreal day, and it's just going to keep continuing throughout the season.
And this is a team that Kyle Hallock, speaking of the Bowling Green head coach, talked about this team was ready to take a step. He did not know how big of a step that was going to be determined by the players on this team. They went last season 20-30 overall, 13-17 in the MAC, 18-34, 14-24 in the MAC season before, and 20-30 and 18-22 in the MAC in Hallock's first season in 2021. They were predicted to finish eighth in the preseason poll before this season. And you look at the team now, and they sit at 11-8 and 9-0 in MAC play. They are 9-4 in March now, after going 2-4 in February, weathering that out-of-conference storm that they had to face off against Middle Tennessee, Memphis, and Tennessee. You face those programs. Middle Tennessee State had two pitchers drafted last year. Memphis is always a good program, and do we have to say anything about Tennessee, eighth-ranked team in the country, when you faced them? But this team, once they got into conference play, I mean, this offense just doesn't let up. They combined for 15 hits today. You're running out of words to describe this offense, Chaz. And if this relief pitching can do what they did today and yesterday and the day before, which is just enough, like not too much, you're not asking too much of them. Sure, it can get better. It could be worse also. They're not blowing games is what you're saying. And I mean, if this offense keeps rolling the way it does, this is a very hard team to beat in the Mid-American Conference.
That's right, Tyler. I couldn't have said it better. There's no words that fully describe this team. Unreal, explosive, just their ability to keep games going, to keep everything under their own control is absolutely just astounding. It's absolutely crazy. And you're right, the pitching situation is starting to get figured out. You saw earlier in February and in a little bit of March that they just couldn't get things going. Now they can get things going like they haven't been able to before. It's amazing.
So now, after being home for three games, they are going to go 9 straight on the road. This team will, in 2 days, face Notre Dame on March 26th. Then the 28th through 30th, they'll face Xavier. And on April 2nd, they will face off against Oakland. On the 5th through 7th of April, against Northern Illinois. And then on April 9th at Ohio State. After that, they will return home for a extended home stand, starting with Purdue, Fort Wayne on April 10th, before getting back into conference play against Central Michigan. So it'll be until April 10th until you can see this team back in Bowling Green. They're going to have to go weather the storm on the road once again. But, I mean, this team is on a – you really don't have words to describe it, because it's a novel run they're on. It's never happened with this program. 9-0 to open MAC play has never happened, let alone 8-0. So this is just a historic run this team is on right now. So that'll about do it for us here at Stellar Field. Like to give a few thank yous first to my broadcast partner, Chaz McNeil. I know you've wanted to do a baseball game, finally getting on a call. Good to have a call with you here today. Also to our board operator back in Coolin Studios. Thank you, Artie Abrego, for getting us on the air. Couldn't do it without you there. Also like to send a thank you to Steve Iwanek, the Falcon Media Sports Director, for setting up all these events, and Carl Smith, the Falcon Media Advisor. Nothing would be possible if it weren't for Carl Smith. So that'll do it for us here today. For Artie Abrego and Chaz McNeil, this is Tyler Cavillett saying so long, and have a good day, everyone.
This has been a presentation of the Falcon Media Sports Network on 88.1 FM WBGU.
We are live outside the home of Joe and Rosie Goddard, where a pretty big...